can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Well, we did forget that.
Where is Noah? Come on.
For goodness sakes.
Yes. Is it kind of discombobulated in here today?
Yeah, hold on.
There you go. That's what I wanted to get. Now, come on in, fellas. They're already here. They're waiting. Waiting for the Joe Gibbs press conference.
Very exciting.
Based on a true story, he was a neo-Nazi with one true enemy. Himself. A man of faith. A man of hate. And a soul torn apart. Viewer discretion advised.
They hope he goes back to the white uniform.
Good afternoon, Mr. and Mrs. Presley, and all the ships at sea.
Happy birthday, E.
Ready to be your tampon. Don Geronimo and Mike, I don't have any chapstick. Oh, Vera!
Yeah! All right, hi, thank you for listening, everybody. Don and Mike Show, new episode on this Thursday.
Thursday!
1-08-04. Oh, hi, Buzz. I got it. There you go.
Hi, Don and Mike. Buzz Burbank here.
Wow. Did that suck.
Forget it, man, and get with the countdown.
Trying.
Take this square world and blast off for Kicksville.
Shout out. Emergency shout out. It is impossible for radio station WJFK to have a live show on before our show. Now, it's amazing. We somehow are able to turn the studio over to Ron and Fez.
Uh-huh.
When we get done,
yes.
Ron and Fez are the guys that come on after us. We're out of here. We're cleaned up. We're done.
Mm-hmm. Everything's ready for that show to come in here.
So they can come in. Today...
Today it's totally turned upside down.
Mm-hmm. See, everybody in D.C. is just quivering because of this Joe Gibbs thing.
Quivering.
And today...
What do they call it in prison? A shakedown?
Yes. Today on WJFK, which is, of course, your community leader...
The studio is shaken down.
the station is the rights holder, the franchise thing for the Redskins. So they put... Larry Michael on.
Yes, to talk all about it.
For an hour today, for an eargasm. And it was a good show, and all of the we're going to the bowl. Right. All of those calls were coming through. My only problem is the fact that Larry got done doing his, the Redskins thing.
He done did it.
At 10 minutes before this show was over, yet...
And the studio was just covered with feces.
And nothing was...
And he can't work in that environment.
No, nothing was turned on. None of our machines were here. We didn't have the...
Don and Mike Show.
We didn't have that thing. We didn't have
your monitors, your computer screens.
Everything, but everything is set
your
now.
Your liver machine.
Phone number. That's your liver machine. It's my dialysis machine.
I always get that confused.
Yes, but other than that, everything was okay.
Yeah. Phone number 877-365-3636. That's from anywhere in America. From Canada, call 800-636-1067. In Washington, D.C., 202-432-1067. You can call anytime, of course. We'll have a phone scan today. More than one, I hope. Happy birthday, Elvis. I know that it's... Yeah, Rob, right. I know it's a big news day with this Joe Gibbs thing, and the Elvis birthday is going to be pushed way down to the bottom of everybody's stack.
Wow.
But just keep in mind that had Elvis lived, he would be in his fourth year of collecting Social Security.
Wow.
He'd be the big 69er?
Yeah.
69er for
Next
Elvis.
Year will be a real big one. Next year will be the big 7-0.
That's right. Wow. And his nails keep growing.
So we'll be celebrating Elvis's birthday. Now, this Joe Gibbs coronation will happen today at 5 p.m.
Right.
East Coast time, 2 o'clock if you're listening to us on the West Coast.
This, of course, is a national story, but here in Washington, D.C., people are going out of their minds.
It's huge. Now, we were faced with this discussion today. WJFK, our radio station, wants to carry the Joe Gibbs news conference, press conference, the announcement that he's become the king.
Uh-huh.
They want to carry this. And, I know we're both for this. We were goofing Gibbs yesterday. But
yeah, I mean, we want to see it as much as anybody else, and we will have it for you.
He's the best guy that Snyder could have picked for the job.
Mm-hmm.
So, having said all of that, we will give you live coverage today of the Joe Gibbs press conference.
Cool.
With our commentary.
Yes, even better. During the slow moments.
Or as I mentioned to somebody up on the third floor a couple of hours ago, maybe we'll just forget to turn our microphones off while we're watching and while we're listening to the feed of the Joe Gibbs press conference.
Absolutely.
Because, you know, Snyder's got to be there and they're going to have a...
I think you can probably count on a bit of respect when the coach is speaking.
Sure. For a while. For a while.
But, you know, as far as anybody else is concerned...
Until we start talking... Hi, Coach Short.
Sure is great to be back here in the nation's capital.
Sure is. I know my friend Dan Reeves is feeling kind of lonely right now in Atlanta.
You know, he's out of a job, and I'm back in the saddle again. And speaking of saddle, I'm wearing my special chaps.
And, Coach, just for you, I have my special Super Bowl XXIIVII thong on.
There's nothing quite like you in a thong. I'll tell you that right now, Dan. Good luck picking up with another team somewhere, and I guess for now we'll have to
agree to disagree. Oh, where's my pills I do my ads for? Listen, Joe Gibbs, so we'll have it for you. Trust me, we'll have it.
Excellent.
Let me call back to the office, get an update from super producer Charles Broyhill about an upcoming project, an experiment we're doing on the show.
Stinky pills.
Howdy, Joe.
Hi.
Oh, and listen, hold on. I almost forgot. It's a good thing you're here. Joe,
yes, it is.
Joe has a tape for us today.
Yeah, Joe brought in something for show and tell.
Nice. This is a sex ed tape. Oh, and here's Charlie. Hi. Charlie. Our sperm test. All of us getting our sperm test to see who's the most potent.
Correct.
We're working on that?
Working on that.
Great. And will we do it here or at the doctor's office? Or?
Well, I hope we can do it here and just give everybody a hand.
All right, get out.
Okay.
Thank you. Do it here?
Like in the studio?
Wow. No. What I meant is they
yeah, here,
they,
one at a time.
I wouldn't be able to pull that off.
They would
I'll
come.
I'll give you a hand.
No, that's precisely the reason I won't be able to pull it off.
They would come, no pun intended, to the radio station, and each of us would go in a room. You know, it's like, what do you want to do? Do you want to drive all the way to a doctor's office and go in a room and get your jerk on?
Can we do a contest?
I prefer to go to a doctor's office.
Can we do a contest to get six fluffers?
Now you're talking. Now I'll do it anywhere.
Yeah. No. Right. You're the one guy.
You know, best of all, wouldn't it be great to do it at home? If we could do it at home? I think it has to be fresh.
It would be, but I remember from when I had to have mine done over 20 years ago.
I'm going
to
need a little with DirecTV.
With Bart, I remember the deal was that the substance was made, and then we put it in one of those, like, you know when you go to Wendy's?
What, you did it at home?
Yeah. You go to Wendy's or Roy Rogers, and you get those little plastic containers, and you put a dollop of mayonnaise in there,
or ketchup or whatever,
and you put the plastic top on.
Right. Yeah, okay.
So what we had to do was put it in there, and then drive like 80 miles an hour on the Kennedy Expressway to get it to the doctor as soon as possible, because it had to be rich and fresh.
So it'll have to be either. Well, then I would assume we're going to probably have to do it at a doctor's
office. At the doctor's office. Mm-hmm. But we are in fact, looking into getting our sperm.
Can we bring friends?
Yeah, can we select a volunteer? Or?
Well, Buzz, I think you're fine with anyone in the videos that you've given us.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, and Mike, if you'd like, you could borrow my Jenna Jameson video.
I'd love to. That would be very helpful for me.
You would.
I mean, I don't think a magazine's going to do it.
Yesterday, you repulsed at the thought of using someone else's porno.
Yeah, but for this, I mean, for this experiment, this grand experiment,
science.
Yeah. Gotcha. Doctor, listen, really seriously, tell me the news. Why am I such a freaking nut? I live in a city where everybody is on their ear about this Joe Gibbs thing. It's football everywhere. Football's on this weekend, Saturday, Sunday, two games both days. Yet I cannot look at this like the glass is half empty. I'm super down because I know that after this weekend for me is as good as it gets.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I know you go through a tremendously bad February
into a funk
when we have the football withdrawal.
Mm-hmm. Because, you know, and this is how they get you, that they give you the games and you buy the games, and then towards the end of the year they start putting these crap games on Saturday afternoon, like Buffalo-Indianapolis, a Saturday at 5 o'clock. What schmuck is going to watch that game? Well, I do.
Yes.
I do. So I normally watch all day on Sunday and watch on Monday night. I watch the occasional Thursday night, I watch Sunday night. But then, towards the end of the season, you have three games on Saturday. That you got a 1 o'clock game, you got a 4 o'clock game, and then you got an 8 o'clock game. And you got three games
You have three on Saturday?
Yeah, there's been three games on Saturday during the regular season.
Yeah, but now there's just one game, right?
There are two this Saturday.
Two this Saturday and two on Sunday?
Right. Yeah, and then after that, just two games the following Sunday, and then 2 weeks later, just one game.
The
and
big
then,
game.
And then that's it. Here's what I'm saying. You got to find a better way to wean me. If you're going to wean me off...
That's why there's arena football.
If you're gonna, and I love saying, if you're going to wean me off...
Wean me off, baby.
If you're going to wean me off, you're doing it backwards. Put all the games on in the beginning and make it less and less and less and less and less towards the end. When we get towards the end of the year, don't jam it all up there so I'm caught into this awful... I'm caught in a trap.
Like with a nicotine patch.
You know, you are looking dreamy, though, today. You are looking as dreamy as I've seen you look in a long time.
I got my good-looking new...
I mean, that is just a smart, snappy-looking... And I don't usually do that to you. I don't give you a compliment like that. You look just crisp today. You look good in that turtleneck. The turtleneck looks good. You lost the weight, and you look good in the turtleneck.
Will you wear that today of the contest?
The sperm got good. I wear this. Well, if it helps Mike, I will.
Oh, okay. All right.
You just look snappy today. You look sharp.
Thanks.
It's that cream-colored Green Bay Packers. Is that a Green Bay Packers turtleneck?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, there it is.
Of course it is.
Right.
They all are. Of course. Everything is. So my point is in this that it's like...
I know you're in your advanced funk, which... It never makes sense to me because you look forward to the disappointment almost. You're anticipating the disappointment.
You know, and good for you for saying that because I'm very much like you are with the Red Sox. When I say you're like the beaten wife coming back for more, except it's not the fact that I'm aligned to any team. You know, I like the Packers are my favorite team. I like the Redskins, even though I hate Snyder. I obviously now like the Ravens. Mm-hmm. I like a lot of teams, like a lot of guys do. The Packers are my main team. But the point is, it's the fix of having it there.
Right.
It's the fix of knowing, and here's what it is, that no matter what goes on during the week, on Sunday, and sometimes the best time of all day Saturday and Saturday night, and all day Sunday and Sunday night, nobody bugs me.
Right.
Because it's the one thing that they all know.
They know.
Where they don't even go in there because I'm watching.
Do not go in there.
I'm watching and I can be rude to people. People call me up on the phone and unless you want to talk about the game, I'm watching. Goodbye.
Right.
And now I realize in less than a month, I don't know what I'm going to have to do on the weekends now. I mean.
Well, you started to get into the golf game last year.
Yeah, I know. There's lots of stuff that I can do.
They're diversions. I know you won't adopt
nothing is like
my great American pastime. You won't get back into baseball because then you'd have something to start thinking about in the beginning of February as spring training approaches.
It's just me in a weird day. And I really woke up this morning thinking, wow, this weekend is like the last great weekend. I'm not even excited about it. I'm such a dick. And then I didn't get mad at my wife. I didn't even mention this to my wife. It has nothing to do with this football thing. We were cleaning out a bunch of stuff, and I don't know. Maybe you can tell me if it's bad luck.
Okay.
That, you know, we've been married 123 years now, and we were cleaning through a bunch of boxes and memorabilia and pictures and junk like that. And one of the things that she had pulled out of one of these boxes was her wedding dress. And it had been kept in less than favorable conditions. Been downstairs. We had the basement flooded a couple times.
And so it had gotten water damage.
And it didn't look really great.
No.
And it was still all wrapped up in the bag, though.
Ah.
It just had, like, some brown spots on it.
I bet she fits into it. I mean, I bet she fits into it quite nicely. She's probably...
It's a moot point. Because
right.
She looked and she said, well, look at this. We could just throw this away.
Uh-huh.
And I went, sure, go ahead, throw it away. The whole time thinking, now is this some kind of a curse?
Well, I'll
is this
you,
bad
done,
luck?
You know, the way I would look at it, I don't know whether I'm overstating it, but I think you probably jeopardized the Smithsonian. You know, by throwing it away.
They don't have
don't you think it's...
They don't have that special wing yet, Mike.
But really,
but
I mean,
will.
You? I don't know about you. I've given lots of thought to our museum.
The sea wing. Oh, you're talking about for our museum.
Our museum, or of course, you know, being national treasures, which maybe you think it's some sort of joke when we say
but
that.
But we're regional treasures.
Well, I like national treasures.
Well, I'll compromise. We're coast-to-coast treasures.
Coast-to-coast treasures. I thought that the Smithsonian might like something like the memorabilia.
All I know is that they're going to have to redouble security at all area landfills because everyone's going to be after that garment.
That'll be more popular than that lady's lottery ticket.
So anyway, I've had that on my mind. Is that bad luck? I know she didn't mean anything by it. She's on this whole goddamn kick about getting rid of clutter and you know, everything
right.
that she's always doing. And it was just... You were going through pictures. You want this one? No. This picture? No. You want this one? No. You want this thing? No. You want this one? No. And here's part of the problem. she's going through memorabilia and stuff from my radio career mm-hmm. that I really don't want, but there's some stuff like there was a plaque for a Led Zeppelin album that the record company had given back when I was playing records. I was a music director.
Right.
And I held it up and I went, wow, that's cool. Hey, look, that's my Led Zeppelin plaque.
Right.
That's cool. She said, right, we can throw that away. And I went, all right, you're right. It really didn't. It was, you know, 25 years
sure.
ago.
Right.
It's garbage. Then she goes, oh, look, here's one for the Little River Band.
Mm-hmm.
She goes, look at all that.
These are like your gold records?
Yeah, one of them was a gold record, and one of them was like a laminated album cover.
Okay, right, right.
That 1970 right. style with a little plaque saying, yeah. you know, thank you from Capitol Records. So I said, no, you don't throw it away. You're right, that's junk. Throw it away. The wedding dress comes up, and there's not even a discussion. The wedding dress comes up, and it's just, oh, we're throwing this away right now. I bet this is her. Hello?
I didn't throw away Boz Is My Cause yet.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for that. Yeah, there was one...
Boz Skaggs?
Boz Skaggs.
You both like Boz Skaggs.
Big Boz Skaggs supporter.
But he's going to Rob A. I figure for the museums that Rob A. is the curator.
You know, that I could not think of a more perfect decision. I think Rob would not only is great at memorabilia, but he would be able to, you know, hold all our stuff.
All right.
Rob, you'll be happy to hear from Grandma's stash. I'm working with Grandma going through all her stuff. I've saved the Lonnie Anderson, Burt Reynolds signed photos for you.
Hey, now.
All right. Very exciting.
Now we're in business. But listen, really seriously, don't you think that that was in some way bad karma? That we're sitting in there and you've got this thing in a bag and we're going through all this junk, which I agree mostly is junk, and you go, oh, it's my wedding dress. Oh, we can throw that away.
Well,
isn't that like a girl thing that you would want to hold on to that?
Who's going to want that wedding dress? I know Bart's bride, whomever she may be, it was no Vera Wang, believe me, in our day. It was like the Montgomery Ward special. Nobody's going to want this wedding dress.
I suppose if you guys had a daughter, it would be a different story. You might hold on.
Well, but still, I mean, we think even if it's a piece of junk, you know, it's got to have some sentimental value. And,
right.
Now, it doesn't to me because I'm a guy. I don't care. I said throw away the Little River Band thing.
All I remember about it is it was on sale. I mean, and if we get renew our vows, which I have asked you to do a couple times.
I already did that once, honey.
No, that wasn't a vow renewal. We didn't renew our vows.
Oh, right. That's when we found out that there was that
slip-up. We weren't really married.
Right.
We needed to get married again,
that's
according
right.
to your lovely mother.
You had planned to at Graceland, but it fell through.
Yes, thank you, Rob. Thank you. Don't forget, yes, I did offer it up, and I offered it up in the most exotic location that a man could offer to remarry his wife in Graceland.
Well, if we hadn't gone through with that, I would be saving my white sequin jumpsuit.
Our curator, Rob Stewart.
Mm-hmm. Well, listen, do you think that it's bad luck in any way that you just threw that away, that you just went, don't need this, throw it away?
Well, I wouldn't do that if I thought it was bad luck, but I tell you, I am rethinking the whole lucky thing since I wore your lucky Green Bay Packers socks, and you didn't know that the other day. And then that day, I won a $5,000 gift from the Georgetown Park Mall.
You won a gift?
On Tuesday, I didn't even know I was entered in a contest, and I swear to God, I woke up and in my drawer I saw his lucky Green Bay Packers socks. I thought, oh, I'm going to work out. I'll just wear these lucky socks. And then later that day, I got a call that my name was entered in a drawing. Really, truly, I have to pick up my prizes next week. I won $5,000 worth of prizes.
Wow.
I can think of no one more deserving.
winning
a contest.
Those lucky socks on watching football. Those are now my lucky
socks.
That's
a lot of money. You must have some really cool stuff.
I don't know. I have to pick it all. They said, come with an empty car, because I have to pick up all my prizes and have my picture taken on Tuesday.
How cool is that?
Do you see the benefits that are coming to you always from being married to me? And all those years that you mocked my Green Bay Packers. My lucky socks.
Mm-hmm.
You wear my lucky socks for one day, and boom, you win a fantastic prize.
I want the whole lucky outfit. I want it all down to your lucky underwear that you have. I'd give it to her.
That's fantastic.
All right, baby. Well, listen, congratulations on winning that contest.
If you get something you hate that you think I like, keep me in mind, okay?
I'm going to have birthday presents for many people for many moons to come.
That's all right, darling. Well, sleep well, knowing that you threw away your wedding dress. sleep well.
Okay, thanks.
And as you mentioned, have fun with your mom's stash. Because I think you said you were going through your mom's stash.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering, what...
Keep me in mind.
Yeah, don't forget about Buzz if you're going through your mom's stash.
I wish it were a stash. I wish to God it was. It's not an easy job, believe me.
All right, darling. I'll see
All right.
you.
All right, there's, Goodbye,
bye, love you. There
hey,
she is.
Hey, hey, and by the way, I don't like that. Mike says you're looking particularly handsome when I'm out of town.
But he's just looking crisp today. He's looking
you
very
would hate,
sharp.
You would hate the way that I'm dressed today. You'd make fun of me. I have on khaki pants and tennis shoes, and I've got one of those Packers golf shirts that you got me, the turtleneck one.
But you just watch about looking too good.
I can't win with this woman.
He can't help it.
I can't help it. I'm gorgeous, darling.
That's right. Hey, Frida, don't worry. I won't go home with him.
I'm so hot.
All right. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Goodbye. So she throws away the wedding dress, and it's nothing.
But it bugs you. You wouldn't bring it up if it didn't bug you.
Yeah, I was
concerned.
It's not even concerned.
Well, because, superstition, you know.
Maybe it's a sign.
Yeah. See?
Maybe
it's a sign from God.
Maybe it's a sign from God.
But it's in the trash.
That God is.
Is it gone now? I mean, is the decision
yeah,
made?
No, it's the trash man has it, not recoverable. Yeah, it's gone.
Was it stained at all? I mean, with the water, was there water damage?
No, there was no water damage. This is what
it could have been worn. Was it yellowed at all?
Not yellowed. Maybe a light brown.
Yeah.
On a couple
but
of
like
spots.
It could have maybe been laundered and regained its freshness.
Still in the bag, but still she threw it away.
Huh.
So I don't know.
Well, good luck.
Anyway, that's it. That's all I got from her. She threw away.
Well, just thank God that the only thing that was thrown away was the dress. There you go.
Yeah.
That's the way we're looking at it.
Okay.
Sometimes the husband's thrown away.
I understand. I got you.
That's a joke, incidentally.
That's right.
I have to say that.
Listen, speaking of Mike, you just did.
Yes. Just speak of myself.
What's the latest?
It's always about me.
No. Listen to this. Are you kidding? I've been swimming in Lake Mee here. What's the latest on the pond? The pony.
No latest. I'm planning on picking the kids up about 9:30 on Saturday morning, mm-hmm. meeting my friend out at the horse trailer, and then heading southwest to get the pony. Hopefully with no bad weather, so that the because it's going to be very cold.
Very cold.
And I hope the pony is nice and warm.
To get the pony.
And I'm thinking about the accoutrement that I will require for the pony, like hats. You know, the helmets,
carrots,
and saddles,
sugar cubes.
But I mean, he's got the fun. I got to call my buddy Jim
tomorrow.
You're
going to buy a hat for your pony.
I'm going to call my buddy Jim tomorrow morning. I'm going to get a complete update on the pony. I'm going to let you know exactly what we need, what we're going to have, and how it's all going
to
go.
Don't forget to get a small pull cart.
Rob wants the pull cart. I know the kind of pony your picture's
Hold
right.
on.
The big furry head.
Yes, exactly.
Right.
Guys, I forgot. My apologies. Joe was on the line here. There he is. Hi, Joe. Sorry about that. Frida called in. Joe has something for us today. An excerpt from a videotape circa 19 what, Joe?
Oh, late 60s, I suppose. I don't have an exact copyright on it.
Sex Education for Trainables. And that,
the ABCs of Sex Ed for Trainables.
The ABCs of Sex Education for Trainables.
And this, for retards. And this is a videotape that I guess we're going to be watching. Joe, you have the whole tape?
Yeah, I do.
So one day soon we're going to be watching the whole, listening to the whole tape.
Oh, it's hysterical.
So here's just a snippet now. Joe Ardinger presents
the ABCs of Sex Ed for Trainables.
Oh, excuse me, Ricky. Ricky, I did see what you were doing. It felt good, didn't it? It's all right. We all have feelings like this sometimes. I'm just glad you're doing this in the privacy of your own room. When you're a little bit older, we'll have to talk more about these feelings and what causes them and how we can control these feelings. I'm sorry I intruded on your privacy. I'll be sure to knock next time, okay?
So was he getting his jerk on? Was he wearing his man?
Yeah. He's sitting in his bed and his blanket's going up and down.
Oh, man.
Can I use that tape if we have to go to the doctor's office?
Hey, Mike should bring his portable DVD player.
Wow. Yeah. All right, well, Joe, when can we watch that thing on the show?
Anytime. I've got it right here.
All right, how about tomorrow?
Tomorrow.
My
wait.
I think it's about 20 minutes long or so.
The ABCs of Sex Ed for Trainables. All right. Thank you, Joe.
Good, didn't it?
Thank you, and I know we've got a break here.
We do have an emergency shout out
because we do have it's a trainable alert. Hi.
Hello.
Hi, is this trainable Tom?
I don't think so. Hello,
Tom.
Come on, sir. Whoever's on the... Hello?
Hello?
Is this Tom Gavin?
No.
Oh, are you just some other guy named Tom?
No, I'm not named Tom. I'm calling to... I'm here in the D.C. area also.
Yeah?
And I'm a huge Packers fan. I wanted to tell Don to have Frieda watch the game and wear them lucky socks.
Oh, okay.
The pack
wear them lucky socks.
All right, I'll have her wear them.
Wear them lucky socks.
Thank you for the call. You see, whenever it's my fault, DJ Error, whenever I see on the screen that Joe has Tom.
It wasn't Tom Gavin Don, but it was a trainable. It was.
We'll be right back, everybody.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
I'd like to try to do my latest record. I tried it last night and didn't make it. I don't know the words to it, so I had to read it. If we give it up, just, you know, please forgive us.
The Don and Mike Show. Drink your mead, but in moderation. No man is called discourteous who goes to bed at an early hour. Just ask Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
We do a giant show on Elvis' death day.
Right.
And that's when it's all Elvis, all the time.
Right.
Our tribute to Elvis' death. Well, that you always have to correct me. It's not a tribute.
It's not exactly a...
Well, it is a tribute.
Yeah, it is a tribute. Yeah. You sometimes call it a celebration.
You call it a celebration.
A commemoration.
A tribute to Elvis.
Yeah. It's not a tribute to his death. It's a tribute to him.
Right. It's a tribute to all.
Did you call it a celebration?
A celebration. Thank you, Mike.
That's the error.
It's a celebration. It's a celebration of all the things that led to the untimely demise of Elvis.
It's a celebration of his life.
Right. And today. Today it's his birthday.
I have to explain this to you guys every year. We're observing it.
Observe that.
Not celebrating it. We're just observing it.
But it is kind of a tribute. And whenever we talk about Elvis, it's a tribute.
It's an homage.
An homage, if you will.
So it's Elvis' birthday. He would have been 69.
Wow.
We're not doing a whole show about it. We'll do a break about it. We've got some great tapes that we haven't played in a while. Oh, and just in case, you live in Washington, D.C., or you're a football fan and you're interested in this, we will have the Joe Gibbs press conference live at 5 o'clock, and I'll tell you that we will give you something that really you can get nowhere else. Mike and I will be offering commentary during the press conference.
There you go.
That's right. Speaking while they're speaking, commenting on what they're saying,
right,
and their appearance.
Because really, any of those press conferences are usually pretty boring.
Yes, yeah, it's going to be the
They're good at the beginning, you know, when the guy first comes out. And
just
then,
like Hitler, Mike.
Oh, dear.
Good at the beginning. Joe Gibbs built good roads in the beginning.
I love it when you quote Marge Schott.
But, yeah, they'll bring him out, and that'll be a moment when I'm sure we'll be quiet. But then once it gets into it,
right,
it'll be all the same boring questions and all the same cliche answers. It'll just be Joe Gibbs saying it, which
you makes think the
it,
little guy's going to talk?
Makes it exciting. Yeah. Oh, my prediction is it's the little guy that brings on Gibbs.
Oh, yeah. Sure, of course.
So, go first. Yeah, we'll have a chance to get Stuart Little. Anyway, that's 5 o'clock.
5 at 5.
And 2 o'clock on the West Coast.
Right.
And, yeah, we're not just going to be playing the audio.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be commenting.
Pretty big story.
And watching it as well. And it's Elvis's birthday.
Uh-huh.
Did you get that music grabbing?
I think it's accidentally at my house from the last time I took all the discs.
Ouch. Sorry. Because we had this CD called Symphonic Elvis.
Yes.
Which is beautiful music versions of Elvis.
I always enjoy that when you're reading the Elvis story.
Yeah. Greatest songs. I have one Elvis story that I have selected for this, his birthday. The story of Elvis and toilets and ice makers and drugs.
Elvis had some very interesting habits.
Yeah. Now, Mike, for your choice, I'll give you we have a limited number of stories this year, but we do have Elvis goes snake hunting.
Okay.
Elvis.
I believe that was with a machine gun.
Elvis at the morgue. I know you love this one. Elvis flashbulbs in the pool.
It's my favorite. Yeah.
We have Elvis and baby talk.
Mm-hmm. That's another great one.
Then we have, and this is a good time with Joe's tape, Elvis is sexually retarded.
Right.
And just as a...
That's when he was watching the... that's where he had his affinity for white panties.
And that's also... Oh, look at all the babies we killed.
That's true.
And his mom.
Then you have Elvis loves machine guns.
Yeah, okay. See, I thought that was tied into the snake hunter.
A different one. Elvis loves baby talk. Elvis loves popsicles.
You know what? Hey, yeah. Right there. I'm going to put a request in for Elvis Loves Popsicles.
Elvis Loves Popsicles?
I like that, if you can get to it.
That's not all. I'll go to it first. I'd be glad to. Oh, and we.
I have some.
Because I don't remember that one that well.
We're going to use this.
This is Elvis. Elvis sings the songs of today.
Background.
Happy birthday, Big E. Donna Mike, emergency shout out.
Hi, my name is Allison.
As you are, as you are.
I have no idea who that Allison is, but here's your story, Mike, as we celebrate Elvis's birthday.
Very good. I don't remember the popsicle one, so it'll be fresh.
Yeah. When Elvis did a lot of downers...
That's a good... Now, how can you argue with a start like that?
Perfect.
Oh, and also, we're going to play a tape. I think we're going to play the full version today of the... everything in the newspapers is junk. I'll rip the tongue out by the roots.
By the roots.
Good.
Great audio.
When Elvis did a lot of downers, and especially when he started doing
Dilaudid,
yeah.
He would eat big plates of popsicles.
No, actually, the name of the drug was Look What We Done Did.
At 4 o'clock in the morning, he'd send Hamburger James out to buy $100 worth of popsicles, $100 worth of fudgicles, $100 worth of dreamsicles. And then he would get constipated. We should have bought stock in Fleet Enemas. We'd have made a killing.
Oh, my God. That's bad. I'd like to do that. No.
People on Class A narcotics can't hold anything except solid on their stomachs. It makes them throw up. But the body accepts sweets. That's why they drink a lot of Kool-Aid, eat a lot of sugary things. So we'd keep maybe 100 cartons of yogurt in the suite in Vegas because Elvis would enjoy 30 to 40 at a time.
My God.
Wow. The suite at the Hilton was enormous. It had this big kitchen. Elvis would wake up and go out his door, walk across the foyer, pronounced both ways, go into the kitchen and get some yogurt. He liked it with fruit. So we kept a big bowl of fruit in there. And we kept fruit in his room. One day he called us into his bedroom and he said, I got a gash in my foot. And he did. He had cut a big slit in it. We said, how'd you do that? He figured he was walking to the kitchen to get some yogurt and he was eating a peach and he finished it and just dropped the pit. Who else could cut the S out of his foot on a peach pit in a $3,000 a day suite with 3-inch carpet? Things would happen with Elvis that would become normal.
There you go.
Okay, that's Elvis and popsicles.
I like it.
$100 worth. Fudgicles, popsicles, dreamsicles.
Each. $100 each. Right? Yeah. $300 worth. Hold on. Where's the one that I wanted? I had a good one selected. Hold on.
Is that the morgue?
No, not the morgue, and it wasn't the sexually retarded Elvis.
That would be my pick.
Is that the one you like, Buzz?
Yes, please.
Maybe pleases me greatly.
Oh, that's a good one.
Oh, that's, yeah.
Oh, that's where he like would wear the uniform.
No,
from this
I'm
movie.
Sorry. I'm sorry. And it ties into yesterday. I'm going to have to go with the hot dog rolls.
That's right.
Yeah, you're tying it into the pony.
The hot dog rolls. Can you find it, Rob?
Yeah,
it's in there somewhere. Hot dog rolls is my favorite. While Rob finds that, I'll give you just a brief a snippet of sexually retarded Elvis.
Very good.
Elvis was curiously inept in certain social ways. He was sexually retarded, remarked one of the girls who came to the house regularly, dressed in her nice little tweed skirt.
Big wheels keep on turning.
With her white blouse, black jacket, stockings and heels. All the girls dressed the same.
You're turning Buzz on. That's why Buzz wanted to hear this story.
If Scatter the Monkey hadn't been there, we would have sat there all night looking at each other. Elvis's monkey became the focus of attention. All of the conversation was centered on the activities of Elvis's chimp. It was like a buffer. One night, Elvis took a friend of mine out of the room and made out on a couch upstairs. It was like heavy teen petting, and he got totally aroused. And all of a sudden, he achieved all over his pants. He got embarrassed and said, "Oh, look at all the babies we killed."
Oh, God.
I'll never forget that statement.
Yeah.
All right, that was just one to...
As Elvis sings Sweet Home Alabama.
That was one just to save a couple of seconds while I get into the next one.
Perfect.
Yeah, okay.
Alabama.
Hot dog and hamburger rolls. Although there was a good one about the... You know, I know it was the ice machine.
That's right.
The ice machine was the one that I really wanted.
Oh, when he shoots the ice machine?
Toilet, ice machine, and drugs, you said.
Yeah, that's better than the hot dog one.
All right.
If you could find that one.
We have a file on Elvis that rivals the FBI,
the E-file.
All right, we'll go to the tape while we find the story about Elvis and the ice machine and the drugs. This is from what year, Rob?
This is from 72 or 4, I think.
All right, it's the early 70s when Elvis was well into his drug use.
The greatest Elvis tape ever. We'll play you the full version now.
He's at a concert. He's entertaining me. I believe it's in Las Vegas.
He's in Vegas.
And these people have come to see Elvis, and instead of hearing him perform, they're hearing his sermon.
His monologue.
I got sick one night last week, and I had a temperature of about 102.
Uh-huh.
Wait a minute. Oh, probably 102 temperature. No, I had a temperature. It was a flu going on in this town, and all my employees were dropping like flies, and they were in a room with me, you know, getting me dressed, and they breathed in my face, and so I caught the flu, and I missed one night, which I don't like to do. I've only missed about 6-7 nights in 19 years from illness. You know.
Yes, you're great, Elvis.
Because to me, a germ is an enemy, and I hate the son of a bitch, and I'll fight it. You know, and I went to the hospital. Went to the hospital once in my life. Once in my life. And then it was only for 3 days because they had a little bronchial trouble in the tubes.
I hate germs.
They do in the hospital. They check you for everything in the world.
Exactly.
And I mean, liver. You know, they'll find something wrong with you. They'll create something if you ain't got it.
You ain't got it,
yeah,
honey.
I took a liver biopsy. You know what a liver test is? You know what a liver? You know what to do? The doctor comes in and says, "Don't look at me." Turns your head, takes a needle this long, goes, right between your ribs, pulls out a piece of your liver. I swear to God, that's it. John, you know what I'm talking about.
John.
And so I said, He said, "I don't move for 24 hours. And here I was, I guess.
This is during a concert.
Damn, what do you do to me? I was okay. I was getting well, and he come in and stabbed me. I swear to God, I saw him in the corner of my eye because I can't help it. I'm trained that way. He looked like a samurai warrior. He said, "Shut up!" With that needle, man.
He's totally into the karate thing.
Yeah. Fastest son I've ever seen in my life, won't he?
Karate.
Anyway, when I got sick, a fellow volunteered his services to come in and fill in for me. He was way up north somewhere working or getting a TV show. He does so much. He volunteered to come in and work the show for me. And now that he's been here ever since, he'll open here tomorrow night. I'd like to thank him, Bill Cosby.
Hey, he's not there.
Bill Cosby's not there.
Bill, where are you, buddy?
Oh, now he's going to say he's doing coke.
Where's Bill? I haven't seen Bill yet. Where's Cosby? You mean after I bet Bill up that son of a bitch left? Well, the hell with him. I won't pay him anyway.
Come on, E.
No, I'm only kidding. No, he gets 10 grand. I give him that whether he likes it or not. I'll stick it up his nose. There's a lady in the audience I'd like to introduce you to. She's been in to see my show twice before.
You know, there's nothing better.
Recently, we have a mutual respect.
You know, we don't even comment on this. We're just smiling and laughing.
Ouch. Both of us. And you know who I'm talking about?
Who?
Her name is Vicky Carr.
Vicky Carr.
Vicky Carr, of course.
Of course, Bruce.
Turn around, baby.
Turn around. Turn around, baby.
Turn around. There you go. Yeah. Now she's working. You're working where, honey? She's working at the Tropicana. You didn't change. It's okay. Don't make excuses to me. Sit down.
He's so effed up.
Thank you, Vicky. But anyway, did you hear It's Now or Never? Did you hear the song It's Now or Never? Oh, God, now I got to do it again. It's Now or Never. When I first saw you.
Okay. Hey. Ed, load this one up.
You got it.
While I'm doing this. My Elvis story to very celebrate good. Elvis's birthday. And not mine, like Michael's, but just the ones that we've selected.
Your choice. About. Good one.
In the 70s,
sitting in the morning sun,
Elvis had a lot of periods of violence.
Ooh.
I'm talking about when he wasn't drugged. He was angry about something that was taken out of the show tour. The more he talked about it, the madder he got. He reached over and grabbed a .45, started shooting, just willy-nilly. I said, Elvis, you're going to destroy this house. He said, I don't give an F. I'll build another one. He shot the commode one time. I laughed till I couldn't see straight. It was the funniest goddamn thing I've ever seen. I got a call at the trailer. It was pretty late at night. Whoever was there said, you need to come over. Elvis is mad and is shooting his gun off. I said, okay, I'll be there in a minute. Well, water was just pouring out of the chandelier in the entry hall. I said, God almighty, goddamn, what the hell has he done now? It was beautiful. Water just glistening off that glass and off the lights, too. I went upstairs and I went in his room. I said, what in the world has happened? He said, I need a new goddamn commode. I said, what do you mean? He said, I never did like the black MF-er. The toilet was black, you see. The lever would stick and the commode would run. He had told them several times to get it fixed, but they wouldn't do it. And the water kept running. And it drove Elvis crazy. Anyway, that sucker was all to pieces and water was still going everywhere. He then went down the hall and shot the ice maker in Lisa Marie's room one time because it kept making noise when he was trying to talk. Joe and me were there, and he was telling a story, and every time he'd get to the punchline, the ice maker would make a noise like, and drop the ice, and Elvis would get pissed. Finally, he just pulled out a gun and said, one more time, and I'm shooting it. Well, it did it.
Sure.
And he shot the hell out of it.
Sure. That cracks me up.
And now that we think about it, that .45 bullet could have bounced anywhere and hit anybody.
Sure.
And then here you go. Finally, it's 76. Oh, hi, Robbie.
You know what's never even mentioned in that story is why there's an ice machine in his daughter's bedroom.
Yeah, right.
Matter of fact.
In late 76, Elvis got into liquid cocaine.
I can't do what
he would take strips of cotton, 3 or 4 inches long, soak them in that liquid cocaine and stuff them up his nostrils. Man, you'd stay high forever. You take just a line of coke, you stay up for 12, 15, 25 minutes. Elvis would stick liquid cocaine in his nose. He'd stay high for 3 to 6 hours.
Wow. Jesus.
My man.
All right, Elvis.
Now, as we say happy birthday to the king.
Right. Happy birthday, Elvis.
The best tribute we could possibly give. The best Elvis tape ever.
Oh, I'm hurt. Thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like you to meet one of the fellows who promoted me. The 8th degree black. His name is Ed Parker. He's on 18 tempo schools around the country. Ed Parker.
His karate instructor introduces Drum Line. All right, thank you.
In the audience, it's Ed Book. It's a friend of mine. His name is John O'Grady. He's written a book. He was head of the narco squad in Los Angeles.
What?
For 26 years. And on the 166th page, he's got about 3 pages about me and my ex-wife or so. And about...
Hold on. You know what? Excuse me. We're gonna cut ahead to the best part of this one. Here we go.
Well, I don't pay attention to rumors. I don't pay attention to movie magazines.
Why, Elvis?
I don't read them.
Why?
Because they're all junk.
Mm.
And,
yes, applaud that magazine.
No, I don't mean to put anybody's job down. I'm talking about they have a job to do, and they got to write something. So if they don't know anything, they make it up, you know. So in my case, they make it up.
They make it up.
But I hear rumors flying around. I got sick in the hospital. Well, I was, you know, in this day and time, you can't even get sick.
No.
You are strung out.
Well, by God, I'll tell you something, friend. I have never been strung out in my life, except on music.
Yes. Yes,
Elvis. On music, baby.
When I got sick here in the hotel, I got sick here that one night. I had 102 temperature. They wouldn't let me perform. On three different sources, I heard I was strung out on heroin.
Strung out.
I swear to God, hotel employees, Jack, bellboys, freaks, you carry your luggage up to the room. People working around, you know, talking. Maids.
Jack.
And I was sick. I was, you know, I was getting in a doctor, had the flu, and I met over one day and was like, all across this town. Strung out. Well, I told him earlier, and don't you get offended, ladies and gentlemen, I'm talking to somebody else.
Here we go.
If I find or hear the individual that has said that about me, I'm going to break your goddamn neck, you son of a bitch.
He's not done, yeah, though. He's not done.
It's dangerous. That is damaging to myself, to my little daughter, to my father, to my friends, my doctor, to everybody in my relationship with you, my relationship with the state. It is dangerous. I will pull your goddamn tongue out by the roof.
And?
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
There he is.
Yeah. The king of rock and roll.
He got to wait about 8 months until his death day.
Oh.
That's when we really go all the way with it.
And the nice thing about Elvis is he always ends up giving us something new.
Oh, yeah.
Even from the grave.
You know, and I'm just looking at this packet we have with the stories. Don't forget how Elvis loved donkeys and ducks and turkeys. Don't forget Elvis and his love of cough syrup.
Yes.
Drinking it out of a champagne flute,
yeah,
with a 16-year-old girl who later ODs.
Yes, she ODs.
Don't forget that when Elvis moved into his first house with the swimming pool, he was afraid to fill it with water.
Right.
So he used that to keep the donkey.
Keep the in the swimming pool.
An empty swimming pool.
Right.
And, of course, his love of Nullo deodorant tablets. The time the kid got sick and he had his harem scarum outfit on.
He was wearing a turban.
Put his hand on the kid and said, he's getting better. Let me know.
Call me if his condition worsens.
And then they called him up and they said, Elvis, the kid's okay. And he said, that pleases me greatly. And we'll end this for you, I guess, with, gosh, it's hard to pick the most popular Elvis quote. I would say the one that I hear the most from people when we read the story.
Right.
It's Oh My Peter.
Oh My Peter.
Yes.
When young Elvis, how old was he, Rob? 10, something like that?
Oh, younger than that.
Watching his mom and I think her sister dance.
Mm-hmm. And he would go underneath their dresses. And when he came out one time, he said, Oh My Peter.
Part of his sexual retardation.
Yeah.
Oh My Peter. Anyway, that's Elvis. And that's our happy birthday tribute to Elvis. If you liked it, ladies and gentlemen, we'll join you in approximately 8 months.
Sure.
When we do an entire show devoted to Elvis.
16 August 2004.
Be here.
I bet you wondered how I knew.
Those babes are out there.
So that's all the time we can have on this jam-packed show to say happy birthday to Elvis. We'll be back in less than 10 minutes.
It's the Don and Mike Show.
Gotta tell you, today was just what I needed. Thanks a lot, Harry.
It was my pleasure, Mary.
So you'll pick me up tonight at 7:45?
Oh, well, no, I got a few things to take care of first, but why don't we make it 7:45?
Stop it.
Okay, 7:45.
The Don and Mike Show.
You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Okay. Hi, this is Dorm Radio, D-O-R-M, broadcasting live from the Baker Science Building. Great.
It's the daytime Emmy Award-winning Don and Mike Show.
All right, I was just at the phone numbers there. You can call anytime. Phone scan. What was that, Robbie? He just said they. It was like, was that a burp?
They.
Oh, there was a burp again.
Got gas.
Sometimes these tape machines, they're not tape machines. It's a CD. It's a CD now. It's
they
are. It still burps.
That's a high.
They are.
They,
only
they,
here.
They
are.
They are.
Yeah, I don't hear them burp anywhere else.
Nope, only here. And burping is an inside thing. Back in the day, well, we still do it all the time. For instance, on a tape like this one.
Right.
this continuous loop, really, on a, like an old 8-track.
It's like an 8-track tape.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. I take it, I put it in this machine. You know, most all radio stations are digital now. Most all game.
Yeah, they're not CDs or any of this. It is all programmed.
Yeah, and what we have is what they worked with.
We have machines that we have to press buttons.
20 years ago, so I got to put the tape in the machine and then press the button.
Uh-huh. Everybody loves Donna Mike.
And now, hear that? That's a see, that one didn't burp.
No. A lot of them don't. If they're done properly, they shouldn't.
A lot of times when the tape recues, and we'll hear it again. Now, here's pressing the button.
Everybody loves Donna Mike.
Now, you hear that?
And you can hear that. Because on an 8-track, which I like to call them, on a tape cartridge, you can actually hear the bleed over of previously recorded material. You can turn it up longer.
Right.
Years and years ago, when you used to call the weather on the telephone, sometimes you would get the current temperature is 76.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they'd screw up on the weather card.
Right, 76.
So. Listen, yes, the Joe Gibbs press conference. Jesus Christ, will one more person during a commercial break ask me, are we set for this? Are we set? Are you sure your guys are okay with this? Are you sure you're set with this?
Of course we're sure.
Yes, we're set.
I've
pressed the button right here. I don't hear anything, but nothing's happening out of it.
That's right. They'll probably open the microphone up when it's time to go.
Yes, and we will have our complete coverage.
Winner!
Our complete coverage.
Is Wendell out of the park?
I believe so.
Sure. I'd love to find out if
Winner! Is Wendell there or is he here?
Robbie, do you know if Wendell's there or not?
Somebody's got to be out at Redskins Park actually screwing in the microphone thing, right?
Screwing. I don't know. I haven't seen Wendell all day, so I think that's a pretty good guess.
And Winner!
Rob's answer would be the same one that I've heard you get from everybody else. We don't know.
But they're all very concerned.
They're all concerned
that
to get
we
them
get, that
but,
we get
but are
it
we
on.
Concerned if Wendell's out there, like maybe having an engineer out there to make sure that we get it? Yeah, they're concerned about that, but nobody knows.
Nobody
and
really knows.
Is job one.
Right.
And also very worried about our coverage. And I said, don't worry, I believe that we've positioned this as coverage you will find nowhere else.
There you go.
Please trust me on that. In less than an hour from now, we'll listen to it and we'll have our comments.
I have an innovative emergency shout-out for you.
Oh, hold on a second. All right.
Very exciting.
See, now again, I got to grab the thing and put it in and...
Wendell is not there. Cameron is there.
Oh, Cameron is there. There
Chief Engineer Cameron Gray.
Cameron
very good.
Hi, I'm Cameron Gray, Operations Director. Don't blame me.
All right, dummy. Listen, here's just a few things that caught my eye. I was watching Men in Black 2 for whatever reason the other day. It's one of those things you flip past it.
Right.
You know, you go, oh, well, all right, I'll watch it for a second. And everybody's got cameos in it. Michael Jackson has a cameo,
mm-hmm.
right, that I'm sure everybody saw. And he's like, I want to be Agent M. I want to be Agent M. Well, Michael Jackson, who is facing charges, kid-touching charges,
mm-hmm.
has made a movie. This is not a joke. Has made a movie. An upcoming comedy, and Mike, I know that, you know, with the divorce and everything,
yeah.
that you've been very, very thoughtful about investments with money.
Right.
And you got out of the stock market. And,
right.
And I want to tell you, I think that you and I should pool our resources
okay.
and get into this project.
Uh-huh.
Get into this project. Now, you tell me if this doesn't sound, the movie's already been made, doesn't sound like a winner. The movie is called Miss Castaway.
Miss Castaway.
Yes, and Michael Jackson stars as a secret agent in sparkly attire. Now, I am not making this
no.
up. The director's name is Brian Michael Stoller. He says, quote, Michael Jackson plays Agent MJ. It's a parody on his cameo in Men in Black 2. Now, that's a great movie right there, but wait until you hear who his co-stars are.
He's got co-stars.
Eric Roberts.
Oh, the brother, the king of the B-movies.
The ugly brother of Julia Roberts. Charlie Schlater. You may not know him. He was in the Police Academy movies. And the biggest name of all, Evan Marriott.
Oh, my God.
Oh, boy. Joe Millionaire.
Oh, my God.
So how great is that? This movie's been made. The movie.
I mean, it's done?
It's done.
It's in the can, as they say?
Yes, and if you want to see stills of this movie, this is a very long address, but I'll give it to you. Go to www.brianmichaelstoller.com. Bryan Michael Stoller, S-T-O-L-L-E-R, .com. And Paramount Pictures is interested in distributing the picture that starred
How interested are
Michael
they?
Jackson and what's his name?
Well, maybe it'll be a cult classic like the Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Now, listen, it's been a long time since we had anything about Robert Blake.
Yes.
But I do have to say that.
Man, I don't understand why you're throwing me under the bus now.
The jury pool for this could not have been greater. You got to think, all those celebrities that live in Hollywood.
Give me the jury I like so bad.
Well, they decided that I've got two names here of celebrities. One of them, after a meeting and talking with the people, they said, forget it, we don't want him.
Right.
The other one, they said, bring her back. She's okay.
Okay.
Okay, so the guy that didn't make the cut is Harry Shearer.
I mean, from The Simpsons?
Yeah.
Ned Flanders. And then,
right.
And also A Mighty Wind?
Correct.
Right. The bald guy from A Mighty Wind?
So he probably did what everybody wants to do when you're called in on a case, to be on a jury.
And I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, Ding Dong Diddly Diaz.
It's a Harry Shearer impression, Rob. There you go.
He'd go Ding Dong Diddly Diaz.
Ding Dong Diddly Diaz. Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Hello.
I'm Harry Shearer.
He's out.
I'd love to sit on the jury.
He's out. But you know who made it past the first round?
Who? Hollywood jury.
Christina Applegate.
Yeah.
Wow. Al Bundy's daughter.
That's right. Amazing. Well, you know, celebrities are people, too.
Well, no, they're not, Mike.
No?
No, they're not. No, that's just my opinion.
Okay.
That celebrities are not people.
I'd like to get that piece of ass from, the Al Bundy show.
Yeah.
It's been a while. Rob, we're going to need the tape of either Jenna or Barbie Bush.
Have them both.
Get them both, then, because there's a new book out about the Bush girls.
Oh, my God.
Hi, girls.
I had no idea it was so big.
Thank you, Jenna.
There they are. They don't show their faces at the White House very often. But
you know,
what's that?
Skirt's been riding on my ass all day long.
I know, I can never hear those names mentioned in the media now without thinking of that tape.
Yeah. Now, someone walked around and quoted them. Someone who is in their inner circle,
right,
in this book that's coming out.
They're very much different than a lot of first daughters.
Yes, they are.
You never hear from them.
They're no Amy Carter, I'll tell you that. These girls look at the Secret Service agents as chauffeurs, bellhops, and valets.
Mm-hmm.
And these poor girls, your Bush twins.
What are you doing underneath those blankets?
I don't know. They're victims.
Really?
Mike, they're victims of their daddy's job.
Sure.
They're victims of their daddy's job, and they're complaining, and I don't get it.
So they're not nice.
Do you know that on 9/11, the first thing the Secret Service did was scramble to locate all of the members of the presidential family? They couldn't find Jenna and Barbara because the girls had ditched the Secret Service agents.
Yeah.
And that was partly because...
Cool today.
Partly because their mom, Laura, asked the Secret Service to back off so the girls could have a little more space, you know, for underage drinking and chasing boys.
So anyway, there's a book about that, and that's great. And anytime the Bush girls are in the news,
take off my clothes.
It's always a chance. That was Jenna.
You know, we haven't seen recent photographs of them.
No.
I mean, you saw them.
If I just sit on it?
Not at all. You haven't seen them, and I'd like to see how they're shaping up. I know at the inaugural,
I got one here. Hold on, I got one.
One looked real foxy, and the other was kind of heen.
Oh, here you go. I got it right here. The good-looking one is the blonder one.
Yeah, and I think
mm-hmm. I don't know if that's Jenna. I think Jenna's the party name.
Would you mind helping me?
It's an old photo. That's their daddy's inauguration. That's what I was talking about. That's really the only photos that you see is when they were out there.
You have a newer photo, Buzz?
No, I don't.
See, I don't think anybody does.
No. I read that the dark-haired one now weighs 280.
And she's cross-eyed.
Like hard.
Absolutely cross-eyed. Sorry, I'm not wearing any clothes.
They are.
All right,
they look like bad kids, don't they?
Britney Spears.
They really do.
Britney Spears, we've covered this whole thing all week with the marriage. Last night, I don't know which show it is I'm watching, Entertainment Access tonight. Anyway, they send a film crew down to...
Did you watch On Air with what's his name, Ryan Seacrest?
Oh, I forgot his show is coming on now.
You can't turn the TV on without seeing him lately. It's disgusting.
There's an awful article with him in the Entertainment This Week magazine.
Oh, really?
About how popular his hairdo is.
Oh, God.
About how all the... Hey, tell me, what faggot out there except for faggots, mm-hmm. want their hair to look like Ryan Seacrest.
Now, I thought, and maybe it was that Kathy Griffin when they were at an award show, she made a joke about him being gay. And I thought it was common knowledge that he was gay. And then
he's going out of his way to say he's straight.
Well, no, I saw him with Regis today, and Regis starts going, "How's your love life? What's new in the world?"
And he was talking about his girlfriend of 4 months. So who knows whether that's the beard or what the real deal is.
I think for a while he played it ambiguous as a way to get press.
You might be absolutely
but
right.
But I think he is straight, so. But that's a shame for all the gays out there.
It's going to be on against TRL, and MTV is now telling guests on that show that if they appear on Ryan's show, they can't be on TRL.
Oh,
so that's already started.
Letterman Leno thing. Right. The guy's such a freaking tool. Well, the articles about his hair, about how all guys want to have his hair and how tough it is to be a Ryan Seacrest.
And you're talking, of course, pubic.
Of course, Mike. And the pubic hair looks just like the hair on the top of his head.
It's got highlights.
So on one of these shows, and that was on last night, too, with the Ryan Seacrest. He's so hot and happening. They sent a film crew down to, now hold on, I wrote this down, the name of the town in Louisiana. Kentwood, Louisiana. This is the town that Britney Spears is from, where the dumb guy that she
Jason
married...
Jason Allen Alexander.
The dumb guy...
I just love saying that name.
The dumb guy that she married for a day is down there, and they're pissed. The people down there in this town are pissed, like they weren't pissed at her before. Tammy Shepard, who owns the hair studio on Avenue F...
There you go.
...says... It's embarrassing to have the world looking at our buildings when we have such run-down, bad conditions. She points out that on Main Street, which is now known as Avenue F, it used to have traffic. Now there are no cars. It used to have a movie theater. The people in town are embarrassed. The population of 2,000 is refused, with the exception of these people that are stepping out to say they don't like it. They've turned away from all the paparazzi that have come to the town. This guy, Jason Alexander, came back home, and he had reporters and TV crews and the photographers following him. And
we're embarrassed to see the outside of our building.
And all of the people say, it is chaos, and you must leave immediately.
What is wrong with ye?
Ye must...
Look what we done did.
Must leave right now. I am pleased to tell you this. We mentioned this story yesterday. I read this, and it was on the news last night in the papers today about George Harrison's doctor.
Yeah, the doctor that went on his deathbed, like forcing him to do an autographed guitar.
Well, he took George Harrison's arm, which was dead.
Right,
might as well have been dead. What's his name on Mayberry? Who's the guy that had
Floyd
on Mayberry?
Oh, dead arm. Ooh.
So what the doctor did when George Harrison was dying, I mentioned this yesterday, like grabbed his arm by the sleeve and wrote George Harrison.
Just on horrible. Vitamins. Pathetic.
Yeah. Anyway, so now the doctor's being sued by George Harrison's family because they're saying you had a dead guy.
Yeah, and you totally took advantage of the situation.
Not to mention the fact that, remember yesterday, I told you as well that at one point George Harrison was dead, could not remember his name, could not speak, was dying. The doctor brought his kid in, like a Star Search audition.
Mm-hmm. To do a little mini concert for George.
Yeah, so the family is now suing George Harrison. Here is what the doctor has offered. He says he would love to donate the guitar to charity.
No.
Donate it to...
Is that it?
To charity.
Family says that's not good enough.
Yeah. In fact, a family says that's spin, and mm-hmm. he says, whatever. Liza Minnelli and David Guest, the only thing I want to tell you about them, and who cares about them, but the thing that I've had... See, the thing is... When you're looking at these news stories, mm-hmm. sometimes you got to go to link and link and mm-hmm. link and link and link until you finally get to the link with the good stuff that you never hear.
Right.
Like you hear that Liza Minnelli arrived in divorce court. You see her. You don't see him. Well, here's what he has to say. David Guest's lawyer yesterday said that David Guest has a medical condition. Liza has the medical condition. I'm sorry. David might have it now because Liza has a medical condition. that she has hidden from everybody.
Okay.
The lawyer didn't say what it is that she has.
Really?
That she may have transmitted to David Guest, which incidentally would mean that they had sex, which I don't believe. But the lawyer goes in front of the judge yesterday and says, before we can go any further with this divorce trial, I just want to say that I've been told that she has a disease. I can't tell you what it is. David might have it, and we want Eliza ordered to have a blood test.
Wow.
And they refused to be specific. They announced in court it could be a misdemeanor. And, Buzz, do you know if Liza's going to have to give blood?
No, we don't know yet, but I'll keep watching that and let you know if they make that decision.
So that's...
I don't think they ever had sex.
Yeah, I don't either.
That's great. I don't know how else I could give it to him. And, last thing here. Because it's Elvis's birthday, there's a guy that we have to get on the show. This guy's name is Ken Verana. Elvis's 69th birthday is today. This guy is working on his own tribute. He's traveled hundreds of thousand miles over something like 4 years to collect interviews for a documentary about Elvis. Now, this guy never knew Elvis.
Mm-hmm.
The guy just drove around with his camcorder and talked to people about Elvis. He's going to release tribute as an 11-hour DVD box set.
Just interviews?
Interviews with people.
Just people off the street?
Jesus.
Wow. People still
stupid
making
Elvis
money
fans
off the King of Rock and Roll.
Now, this guy, the hillbilly that's making this
documentary, this guy
that nobody's buying, he has already spent over $250,000
getting it ready.
His life savings going out and interviewing these people, and he doesn't even like Elvis.
Oh, my God.
He doesn't like Elvis. Can you guess the number one spot outside of Graceland where he was able to spot Elvis fans and interview them for his worthless 11-hour DVD box set that nobody will buy?
Was it next to the Elvis Cured My Hemorrhoids sign?
It was not. It's generic. I'll just tell you that he got the majority of his 11 hours for going to NASCAR. He said of all the
wonderful
of all the places that he went, when he would go to NASCAR, that's where he'd find the most people.
Well, I think Elvis would have loved NASCAR and would have probably ridden its popularity to a 69-year-old hit.
So we're trying to get this guy on the phone. For a guy that has spent allegedly over $250,000 on this tape, he does not have a telephone.
Rob will buy it.
You know I will.
Would you now? How much?
Rob is a legitimate Elvis fan.
Would you buy a DVD collection just of the great unwashed saying what Elvis meant to them?
Not only would I buy it, I would make you watch the best parts of it, and you would enjoy it.
There you go.
You know you would.
And I think we're going to hopefully get us a free copy.
Well, I hope so.
You kill me. And last thing here. You know they're so funny over in Britain. The London Telegraph says that if you switch around the letters in the name Britney Spears,
uh-huh,
it spells out best PR in years.
Hey.
Right.
Eat me.
Eat me where food comes out.
Very good.
Okay, you got what I'm saying? Eat me where mom and dad did bad things to me when I was a kid.
Best PR in years.
That's all I've got for topicality. I am ready for a phone scan. How about you?
I am ready, too.
Yeah, your calls, any topic, the rotating random phone scan. Please dial recklessly and know that we're going to be operating on a deadline because we're going to be bringing you this late-breaking news.
Yes.
About Joe Gibbs.
We will be covering the press conference in its entirety.
The story that we just broke moments ago.
Until we start talking.
Joe Gibbs is becoming the coach of the Redskins. But now, phone scan time, so dial recklessly at 877-365-3636. Get on the line to get on the air. We'll be right back.
It's the Don and Mike Show. The mole will lie to your face.
You are one pretty lady. Not.
The mole will double cross you.
Drink this. It's not poisonous.
The mole could be right beside you. And you wouldn't even know it.
Wow.
Who is the mole?
Me.
The betrayal begins Tuesday, January 9th on ABC.
Where are my eyes?
The Don and Mike Show. They are old and pathetic.
Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
Mike, for your edification, here are some better pictures of the Bush girls.
Recent?
Much more recent than the photo that you saw.
Yeah, that was an inauguration photo.
Here they are, looking kind of slutty. One of them looking a little sluttier than the other one. And also the story that we were working on that we didn't get to there, all the stuff I want to talk about, these stories. Here's just the introduction. He is a she now, and his twin is his ex-wife's lover.
Wow. What?
He is a she.
Who?
The person that I'm talking about that we're going to have on the show.
Joe okay. Felix?
He is. That's the press conference, Rob.
He is a she.
Uh-huh. He's a she. All right.
And his twin is his ex-wife's lover.
All right.
But that's not all. They're all living together.
Sure. So
and
this,
one of
this
them
is a transsexual?
Has had the operation.
Well, that's the transsexual then.
Right, I always get that mixed up.
Transvestite and transsexual. So
now,
we have a post-operative transsexual.
Yes.
And his twin brother.
Who is married to his ex-wife, or is his ex-wife's lover.
Uh-huh. Is his ex-wife's lover. So when he became a woman, the ex-wife dumped him and wanted him again and got him through his twin.
Wow. And the man that became a woman and then had his ex-wife fall.
In love with his twin brother.
Is running for mayor of Lansing, Michigan.
Well, of yes. course.
And anyway, that we were trying to figure out. They've contacted us the last couple of days, and we thought, oh, this is like a hoax.
Is that the picture?
Yeah, that's a lovely lady.
God.
That's, I guess, for tomorrow's show.
You know, really, this is for anybody that's considering becoming a transsexual, you know. Yeah. At least have some feminine qualities.
Something we were thinking about there a second ago. Oh, listen, here's excitement. Let's go now live to Ashburn, Virginia, where Cameron Gray is standing by, our retarded program director. Hi, Cameron. And I only mention that because...
Hi, I'm Cameron Gray, operations director. Don't blame me.
Right, he's the guy that made the tape.
Cameron, is it exciting out there?
Cameron?
Hello? Hello.
Is it exciting? Is it exciting?
I have Sun.
Oh
you,
no!
You what happened, Cameron?
I have Sonny Jurgensen on one side of me and Rick Doc Walker on the other. So what else could go wrong?
Are you? Can you hear us, Cameron?
Yes.
Are you intimidated by the fact that you're sitting by these other guys?
Not in the slightest.
Totally intimidated.
Have you had anything to drink today?
No. There's a delay. From when you asked me the question and me answering.
So what's the mood out there, Cameron?
I got to say, it's pretty exciting. Gibbs just walked in and the entourage following him and the cameras. It was a pretty neat experience to watch.
Well, I'm glad that we're going to be bringing our own coverage. And now it's you guys with the microphone, right? So we don't have to, like, listen to anybody else offering their analysis?
No, it's just a live feed. It'll just be Gibbs.
So Gibbs came in already. It sounds like they're a little ahead of schedule.
He's here. His whole family's here. It's a huge entourage.
How about my man, Dan? How about my man?
He's here.
My man, Little
Dan.
Around. Little Dan.
So what they're doing right now, Cameron, out there prior to the formal press conference, is they're working the room?
Yes, they're working the room. Actually, I have a special guest for you if you'd like.
All right, go ahead. Who is it?
Hold on 1 second.
It better be somebody famous.
It's a crowd. It's not an entourage.
is this Sam Huff?
Hey, Sam.
This is Sam Huff.
Hey, Sam, how are you? Thanks for coming on the Don and Mike show.
Hey, Sam. I've been on Don and Mike show before.
I know you have, yeah. Sam. Sam, you got to be excited about this day.
Well, this is a great day. You know, this is a day like when Lombardi came to Washington from, out of retirement.
Right.
Absolutely.
So it's a very special day. Hey, this is a great coach. He's a man that they needed very badly.
Amen to that. Sam, great talking to you. We'll have our coverage at the top of the hour. There, we turn that thing off. There he is. It's very trainable. Sam Huff is a highly trainable guy.
He is.
Anyway, let's take your phone calls, because I guess we're set at Redskins Park, the press conference.
I'm sorry.
Sam.
It's a great day for Washington.
It is.
It is.
It is, Rob.
Sam speaks the truth. Your telephone calls now. Here we go on a rapid-fire type style. Hey, Rob, call back out there. I don't want to go through that awkwardness again and find out if the Redskins are on time with this thing.
Okie doke.
Let's take phone calls up until then.
We have some trainable listeners that will be here.
Phone scan. Hello, Don and Mike Show. Phone scan. Hi.
Radio gods. Rick from Rochester. What's up?
Hi, you're on the air.
Hey, did you guys see the Angelo and Leah special on VH1 about their wedding?
Yeah. Yes, months ago. As a matter of fact, that you're disqualified for bringing up something that happened a while ago.
Hey, I just watched it, man. Come on,
you, it is the one straw that absolutely broke the camel's back. That
you weren't invited.
No. She actually, we talked about it, we criticized it, and then it got back to her that we were criticizing her, and that's when it all fell apart.
So now we're not friends anymore.
Right. Really? We actually left her a message recently, and she never got back to us.
When's the last time you guys talked to her officially?
I don't know. Months ago, please, you got to make a better effort to listen to the show every day.
Amen.
You got to. Hi, Don and Mike Show. Phone scan.
Hello.
Hello. You're on the air.
Hey, I want to talk about George Harrison.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Here's the deal. You guys can call me a bee. You can call me a whatever. I'm so mad.
Are you the
my dad?
Are you the same lady that called yesterday?
No.
Oh no, we had a nutty lady call yesterday about Arnold Schwarzenegger. I'm sorry, I'm getting my nutty ladies mixed. Oh, hello.
Hello.
I think maybe the phones got dumped.
Well,
like
she took so. Oh, they did.
Yeah, I think.
Oh,
so.
Why? Because we said TWA
repeatedly. Yeah.
The beverage that people like drinking on TWA. Well, stay on the line there for a second, honey, until the delay builds back up.
Come on, honey.
I'm George Harrison. I never listened to Don Geronimo. And Mike O'Meara, and I'm sure they never play my records either. Play some of my records, and maybe I will listen to it.
Hey, Jordan, you know, we get a lot of tapes.
Hey, sign this for me. No, it's all right. Come here, sign this for me.
I'm proud of the fact that, you know, he's gone and all. I got that tape personally, backstage in London.
Excellent.
At the Prince's Trust Rock Concert. And I'll tell you, it was exciting to meet George Harrison. It really was.
Very cool.
And I took his hand, and I had him sign my right breast.
Said right there. Wow. Right for me here. Now, see, the problem is that we used a word that I was told got through yesterday on the air. It got through.
Mm-hmm.
We used a word today.
It's a controversial word.
Apparently, everybody in the goddamn building that's not got their ear to Redskins Park. There you go. Thank you. Just padding time. They're trying to explain. It's okay.
Okay.
Everybody hit the delay at one time, which set off all of the telephones.
But meanwhile, this woman had called. She started to get to a point about George Harrison, but never got to it.
So anyway, I'm
trying to.
All right, go ahead, honey. I'm
sorry. I love you, but I'm trying to.
Well, go.
Okay.
Go. We love you, too.
My dad rolled his Suburban 15 times. We didn't know if he was going to make it for 16 days, or 6 days, okay?
Yeah.
If some doctor would have taken my dad's hand and signed anything, God help him, may somebody F him in the A, and may he die and go to hell.
Well, I think we're with you. I mean, I think we think it's terrible what the doctor did. I don't know whether you got any other impression from us.
Yeah.
I didn't. I just, it pissed me off.
Yeah.
And us too.
No,
I just
us,
needed to sound
too.
Off.
Us too. Okay, oh, sound off. Did you need to shout out?
I needed to shout out because I was crying earlier, and now
thank
I'm pissed. Well, you did. I hope your dad's doing better.
What, Robbie?
I don't know why you guys are upset. I think George Harrison's doctor was right.
Hello. Hello.
Counterpoint.
Phone scan. Listen, here's how it works. I pick them up, you answer them. Don and Mike, hello, phone scan.
Hi, Don and Mike. This is Dan in Vermont.
Hi there, Dan.
Hey, I just wanted to say, I know you guys are going to cover the press conference, but I could really care less about the struggles of the Redskins. I just want to kiss you guys.
Thank you, Joe. Don and Mike, hello. Phone scan. And listen, I think across America, you're gonna like this because we're gonna bring you an angle that perhaps you're not gonna get if you're watching on ESPN.
Unique and informative.
If you want to know what it's gonna maybe sound like, if you've ever been in a real formal situation where you're supposed to be in like class or in church, and you know you just want to whisper things, that's what we're gonna be doing.
Yeah, but we'll be able to say them at regular, you know, speaking volume.
It'd be right. Fun if we whisper.
Hello, John and Mike.
Like we're in the back of the.
Like we're in a golf match or something.
Hey, well, look at him over there. Is there something in his nose?
Hello, phone scan.
Don.
Right, and Mike. Hi.
Hi. You're not gonna become a Redskins fan now again, are you?
Oh yes, I already announced that yesterday. Doesn't still mean that I don't think Dan Snyder is a money loving prick. There's no doubt about that, but you have to give the guy credit. It's a brilliant hire. It's a brilliant hire.
Nothing, no hire by the Washington Redskins could be better for the fans than this. I mean, to make the fans feel good. Mm-hmm. Is it going to be successful? That's going to be up to whatever happens in the future. But as far as the way the fans feel about this right now, it is a... It's a gold mine.
And listen, even someone like me, cynical like me, I hate everybody and I hate everything. Even I'm excited about it.
How can you not be excited? I mean, and he's a winner.
Yeah. Like I said yesterday, it pains me to say this, but okay, little guy, good move. Good move. Now climb back into your shoebox and stay there.
Bye-bye.
Hello, Don and Mike. Phone scan.
Hey, Don and Mike, boudets.
Hi there, you're on the air.
How you doing, gentlemen? Long
doing
time
great.
Listener, first time caller.
Right, right.
Hey, listen, I wanted to talk to you. We were talking a little bit before about the gentleman who's doing the Elvis documentary.
Yes.
And I didn't know if you guys are aware, there's actually another filmmaker in your own backyard that was doing something similar about the comic book industry. And I was calling because I think Don...
Okay, that
yeah,
was...
Yeah, right. That was... Way to tie those together.
sounded me hanging up on you. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hey, I want to talk about the Seasucker. They kept pushing the dumb button on you guys during the Best Of.
I don't even know what you're talking about.
During Best Of.
Yeah, the whole time, the whole 2 weeks you guys were gone, it's a new standard now. Pushing it. It sounded like a broken record.
Here's the thing, and you've hit the nail on the head. Standards, and we've told you the standards of this company change from hour to hour, mm-hmm. minute by minute, second mm-hmm. by second.
Yeah, the reason they call it standards and practices is because they're always practicing.
Something that we did on the show a month ago might not be accepted today
right,
by the standards that they have today.
Yeah, when we did that whole show on AFing.
Don and Mike show. Hello. Hello.
We said the words. Can't do that now.
Don and Mike, phone scan.
Hey, Don and Mike, how you doing?
Hey.
I've been listening for about 10 years, and on Monday something happened that I hadn't heard ever.
What's that?
And that is that...
We made you laugh.
No, that Don didn't say rabbit, rabbit, rabbit.
Well, it was too far away.
Yeah, it wasn't the first.
Dude, it was too far away. You got to do your own rabbit, rabbit, rabbits. And I got news for you. My rabbit, rabbit, rabbit this year is the best. 2004 is a kick-ass year for me, and I know this because at midnight,
uh-huh.
and when the ball went down and they said Happy New Year, as I was sitting by myself, I just said, rabbit, rabbit, rabbit. I did. I swear to Christ.
You were
I did.
Sitting by yourself because your wife was not feeling well, right?
No, she was laying. Actually, she was. My wife was the way that I hope we'll always be together. She was out of her mind, zonked on NyQuil.
Oh, really?
And something else, and very much out of it, and almost like.
Was she in another room?
Who's that guy?
Stephen Hawking?
No, Sonny von Bülow.
Yes. Klaus, and you're the Klaus von Bülow?
Does she
suspect what you're putting in her food?
If you have ever seen the movie Jagged Edge?
The whole experiment with cooking the meals now. Don't you think it's about time you come clean and talk about your plan?
And hold on, now I'm getting the mix up. Jagged Edge is the guy that killed his wife.
Jagged Edge was with Jeff Bridges, I believe.
Right. The one that I'm thinking of is the one that has the guy who plays Alan Dershowitz.
Yeah, exactly.
Reversal of Fortune?
That's it.
Yes, I forgot what his name is.
But anyway, his wife, my wife was laying much in the same condition on New Year's Eve at midnight when I rolled over and said, rabbit, rabbit, rabbit. Uh-huh.
I just want to call your attention. Buzz has Channel 9 on.
Jeremy Irons, I believe, played.
Yeah, that's,
yes,
right.
That's right.
Do you realize they have a New Year's Eve countdown in the corner until 5 o'clock, like a minute.
Are they going to do it right? Did we find out?
Now,
I mean, if they are,
we think we should probably take a break. Let's go back out. Can the guys at the hear me out there at the press thing?
I think so.
Hey, Cameron, hello. Can you hear me? Cameron, are they going to start this thing at 5 o'clock?
It seems like it's going to be pretty much on time.
Seems it's going to be pretty.
Yeah, they won't do this early. They want as much media coverage as they can get.
Gotcha. All right, so we can take another phone call.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Sure. Even better.
Oh.
Cameron?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Hey, Cameron, why don't you
I want to start with, hey, you fat bastards, this is Mark from Green Bay. And I'm...
Hold on, I got a guy
on the phone.
I got a guy on the telephone. Cameron?
Yes?
Would you tell the Redskins that we're running a couple of minutes late? We'd appreciate it if they start the press conference about 5 after.
Sure, be right back.
Okay. Hey, incidentally, when you, like, go out to Redskins Park with all the crap that we, and especially me, said this year, like, do they treat you good or they treat you bad or they just treat you? Do they treat you like they always treated you?
They're more than cordial to me.
More than cordial?
More than cordial.
Really?
Are you still sitting between Doc Walker and Sonny?
Sonny is gone. It's now just Doc Walker and Coach Thompson.
Say hi to Doc for us.
Hold on, we got some other guy. Hi there. You're on the air. Go ahead. Phone scan.
Hey, you fat bastard.
Hi. All right. You said it three times.
Heard you a million times.
Moron.
What can we do for you?
What do you think about the Packers' chances this weekend, Don?
Yay!
Yeah, hey there. I'll have my lucky socks on there.
You fat bastard.
Phone scan. Don and Mike, hello.
Yeah, I have a prosthetic leg autographed by Linda McCartney.
That's good. Don and Mike, hello. Phone scan.
Hey, Don and Mike, it's Ken from Arlington.
Hi, Ken.
I was wondering what you guys thought about the D.C. phone ban, the cell phone ban.
Awful. I mean, needed, I guess, if you really care about people's safety, but how inconvenient.
Yeah,
you know, how inconvenient. Absolutely. They got one of these dumb rules here in D.C. that they're going to pass that you can't drive and use your cell phone at the same time.
Yeah, but it's not going to stop anybody from like going across the 14th Street Bridge and eating a Big Mac at the same time they're plucking their eyebrows.
You know what? Thank you. Another day we'll discuss how awful that is. My favorite commercial right now, I think it's for a car insurance, is where a woman's driving down the road and the guy pulls up next to her and he says, and he's eating fast food and he goes, "Hey, I'm driving with my knees." And then she drives a little further down the road, and it's a guy in another car, and he looks up and he goes, "Hi, I haven't slept for over 17 hours." And the purpose of the ad is, you know, something like, "You never know who might be out there on the road."
Right. But no cell phones.
Right. Absolutely.
Yeah, that's DC protecting you.
Phone scan, last call. Hello.
Yeah, do you realize that out there there's still a woman walking around with the words, "This is Sam Huff," tattooed on her place?
Don't you think we know that? Don't you?
This is Sam Huff.
Don't you think we know that? Thank you, my friend. Listen, last caller on the phone scan's got to be abbreviated so we can do this press conference thing. What's your name?
My name?
Yeah.
Trevor.
And where are you from?
I'm from Antioch, California.
And you are listening on what radio station? I have no idea.
KHDK.
Right on, Sacramento. You've won the DVD copy of Sex and the City, the complete fifth season. Now available on Dividend Vicious from HBO. Get it wherever you buy that stuff. And thanks for listening on KHTK.
I love you!
Thank you, my friend. It's very short phone scam. Try to work another one in. We'll be back with our in-depth continuing coverage of Joe Gibbs and the boil on his butt.
Joe Gibbs.
We come right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Hi, my name.
All right, stop it. Minute after five on WJFK. We'll join the network whenever it happens. But they're making all these announcements now at Redskins Park, saying that, you know, stay tuned. In less than 1 minute, this will be happening. So now
I'm very excited.
We're just waiting. There was just a lady, I think it was Michelle, is her name, was just on saying, "Turn off all cell phones." And if one more reporter gets on television and says, "I guarantee you that there won't be another cell phone turned on during a Redskins meeting," that I'm going to puke. Because that's what they're all saying.
Yeah, they're apparently very concerned about cell phones.
Because that's why the team was 5-11, because cell phones went off. Okay, we're here now.
We're waiting. If we were out at the park and we were saying,
"Excuse me, the clock, Rob."
What if I told you that you could reduce or possibly even eliminate your need?
That. You know what we've done? We've actually scratched commercials off. We've broken a cardinal rule by scratching commercials so we can do this.
Be calling the chief cook and bottle washer.
I'm going to call the Pennyman. Let's see where he's at.
I saw him walking down the hall. He wouldn't have left early, would he?
Pennyman.
Alan's at the park, Cameron just said.
Cameron, is Alan there?
Well, the Redskins sales staff is here, and I hear he's on the way.
On the way.
If he's listening, then he'll be elated to know.
Well, if he's listening and you just said you didn't play commercials, he's driven his car into a ravine.
We've scratched about 4 minutes of commercials.
Cameron? Don't let Steve Johnson ask a question, no matter how courageous he looked.
Is Steve Johnson drunk?
No.
Steve Johnson, incidentally, is the director of Redskin Sales and has a problem with alcohol. joining us momentarily will be Coach Joe Gibbs, who's being interviewed now by some schmuck outside.
Who is that guy?
On one of the TV stations.
Look at this guy.
You know, this is going to be weird timing coming back to the network, right? Because we just got to hit the thing that says, incidentally, right now, congratulations, if you're listening to us, we're only on WJFK, and we've done nothing like got fired or had a fight with the Westwood One.
No, we're just waiting because it's a big story here in Washington, D.C., and we're going to bring it to you, the press conference, as we're looking at footage of Joe Gibbs right now being interviewed earlier.
And they're just waiting. For the longest time...
You know what? And we should have known. We should have known.
Well, here's why we got suckered into it, and I'll take the bullet for this one.
What's it? Why is that?
Channel 9, in the upper right-hand corner of the screen...
Had a countdown?
Had a countdown clock. And I'm sitting there, I'm saying to Rob, now, do you think they're going to go right at 5 o'clock? And Rob said, well, they got the countdown clock. So he said, all right, cancel the spots. Now, there's J.C. Hayward.
Hey, looking lovelier than ever.
And wouldn't you love to grab that wig off and see what really is going on that bald, bumpy, pimply head?
And now we're having the pleasure of looking at Frank.
Francis Herzog.
Frank Herzog, who's out of the park, and...
God damn.
What's the deal? It's supposed to be 5 o'clock, eh?
Oh, we can take a phone call. Don and Mike show. Hello, this is a free phone call, and I mean really free, because now we're not playing commercials. Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, where are you calling from?
I'm the guy that won the prize last time. I'm just waiting for my prize.
Oh, hold on a second.
Oh, you won the prize.
Hello, Don and Mike. Who's this?
That's you, Don, you fat son of a bitch. I had less to your stupid-ass commercial.
You'd rather listen to the commercials?
No. I'm from Baltimore, bitch. I've been on hold for 25 years.
Wait, now they're going to it. Hold on.
Hold on,
thanks
for
coming.
My love.
What?
Tonight's one of the most exciting days of my life.
And now we're going to break on the network.
As a 10 seconds.
Fans, oh, is that Snyder?
Should be for all of us. First off, I'd like to just say thank you.
Join the network.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Bueno, ding dong, diligiatimo. Bueno, ding dong, diligiatimo.
How you doing? We're watching.
I know my dad's smiling down on this today.
Little Dan Snyder.
There, smile on this. This is some day. But I'd just like to introduce the head coach and team president of the Washington Redskins, Joe Gibbs.
That's it. It's a good speech.
Kept it brief.
Him I want to listen to.
Now here comes.
Well, first of all, I'm nervous and excited, so if I make a few mistakes here, you'll have to bear with me. I'm going to kind of wrestle my way through this. First of all, I want to thank everybody for the welcome. I mean, to see the people out.
You're welcome, Joe.
I tried to stop and say thanks to each one of them. I really got to tell all of you, I had all the fun.
Do you think he's going to thank us, Mike?
Yeah, I said,
personally, I don't think so.
We're running it on our show today.
I know, really appreciate the welcome, and a little embarrassed by it, so much attention. So, first of all,
hey, for those of you who were away on the network there, what was up with that lady from Baltimore that was saying F you to me?
Because,
I think she was disappointed that you were now paying attention to the other football team.
Any person I know, and so I just want to start off by thanking Pat, and she's always there when the boys and I want to chase some dream, knowing that it's going to be extremely hard for her. So I want to start by saying a big thanks to Pat. Thanks, Mom. The other thing I wanted to do is...
Thank Don and Mike.
It's my years here, and the best part of it is all our new additions to our family. So today we've got J.D. and his wife.
Is he talking about his grandkids?
Right here.
Yeah.
We got...
tell us how you are going to win the Super Bowl.
We got Jackson.
Who he?
Namesake. He can get anything he wants. Miller.
Who he?
Is here running around someplace. And little Jason.
Who he?
And then we've got Coy. And Coy's wife is Heather. I think they're right around here. Both there's Heather.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And Coy's here someplace.
Who he?
We got our little guy, Ty, that's running in the middle of all of that. And we got our fifth on the way from... Heather, I'm all excited about that, and if I can buy another one, I'm buying it. So let's tell you that right now.
Uh-huh.
And both my boys outpunted their coverage with their wives, I want to tell you that. So,
that's a good line.
That's the introduction to the family. And so I want to also be so excited. As you guys know, I got to tell you, I'm a very small part of this. I go into it knowing that. There is no way that we can accomplish what we want without a great coaching staff. Daniel and I have been working nonstop ever since we signed on to...
Not Mr. Cook.
Did he call him Daniel?
Daniel, right.
Right.
As hard as we can, trying to round up, and I think we're going to...
Mr. Snyder, you said Mr. Cook, but yeah, you're right.
Yeah, I mean, that's what he used to say.
Three of those guys are here today. Don Bro, been with me forever. Don and Harleen, thank you. I would be remiss if I didn't tell one story at this point. The very first time I went for a job interview was at Florida State. Don called me a while back. He's trying to wine and dime me. He's got big steaks and barbecue and all this stuff, and I fly across the country. And so Harleen's in there working. They're doing the steaks and everything. So when Don stepped out of the room, you know, he's trying to recruit me as hard as he can. I turned around to Harleen, and I said, Harleen, and what do you think about this place? And she spun around, and she goes, are you kidding me? I hate it. So that got us off to a real rugged start there.
She doesn't
hate really Florida State or anything about it. It was just her way of saying, you better check your whole card here.
I'm the one telling you how it is.
The Bugs is back on the scene. There's Bugs.
Good Bugle.
All right,
I can definitely tell you the best part of him is at home, Brenda. And behave yourself, okay? We got Jack Burns. Jack is here. We're all excited about having Jack.
Yep.
Jack and Robin on board. So
this is what I would say if I was at home talking to you. Or
yeah, absolutely.
Any of you guys on the phone? Enough of the bio. Let's get down to it.
It's a real process, as you know, in the NFL.
Come on, you're coming back.
Next, I got to tell you, Daniel, you and Tanya, I just want to tell you, I really appreciate this opportunity. And I think it's that I need to, you know, I know that Brittany and Tiffany and Jerry are a big part of that. I want to stop for a minute.
Hey, nice names.
Here's what I know about Daniel so far.
Oh, boy.
Daniel.
We got together several times. I asked him to do things for the youth home, Youth for Tomorrow. And as you guys know, nobody gets paid. It's just strictly voluntary. I had Daniel come down. He's had to stand in front of 100 people and get your picture taken. He didn't have to do that.
I like Daniel. It's like he's a father.
His resources and everything. And so the first time I got to really know Daniel was in that situation. And then to see what he thought of this franchise and that he was willing to obviously... financially do all he had to do to try and buy this great franchise.
Show me the money.
So I saw that.
For Daniel.
Then, of course, the thing that probably impressed me as much as anything is the way he treated his family. I got to tell you, Arlette, I'm going to be real nice to you because I understand you could fire me. Is that it? She's an owner. You can have anything you want. Michelle's sitting next to her. I'm going to make sure I take care of them.
What the hell was that? You were playing another tape.
No.
Dresner, Michelle, Arlette, Dwight. Dwight's just been around.
He's doing like a goddamn Oscar speech.
And,
I want to thank Harvey Weinstein, all the great guys at Merrimack.
I really appreciate that.
I want to hear him get down to the nuts and bolts.
What I was saying there, to see the way Daniel treated his mother and father.
Daniel, my brother.
Just meant a lot to me. And I wish Jerry could be here. I know he does. And to see that impressed me. And so what we're doing, the owner and head coach, what we're doing is forming a partnership, and the partnership is going to have to be this. It's got to be one that can overcome a lot of adversity.
It's got to be your way, Joe.
To us.
Please say this politically correct.
And so we're trying to develop.
Here's the partnership. Joe Gibbs runs everything, and Daniel Snyder just pays.
Other things that I've had a chance to witness over the last 4 days has been about as intense. By the way, Corey came in on the side over here. My son will also be on the coaching staff. I wanted to say that Dan and I have been working for the last 4 days as hard as we can work on the coaches.
What a great guy he is.
And all the things that it takes with that. I got to tell you something.
What?
It's already hit us. We faced some adversity in that process. And so to see the way he has stepped up already for me and the coaches is really important to all of us. So having said all that, I just want to say a big thanks. And, you know, we're forming a partnership to try and move things ahead.
Daniel.
That's very important to me. The next thing I would say, hey, you talk about this challenge. I kind of look at it. I didn't wear my Super Bowl ring. I got one. But here's the way I look at it.
I'm not wearing mine either.
Me neither, Don.
For us. We're trying to go forward with our
Buzz is wearing
players
his.
And a whole new group.
Buzz has turned his into a penis ring, though.
From this point on, the past doesn't buy us much other than relationships. We got great relationships. I do know a lot about the town, and so we'll get to that in a minute. But it really, we're focused on the future. We want to try and do something great here, and that's the way I'm looking at it. It's a whole new deal for me. I got to prove myself. And all the coaches, we got to prove ourselves all over again.
Right, Joe.
And that's the way I'm approaching.
Wonder what his sperm count is. Hi.
Okay, this new challenge. Here's what it takes. It takes a great team effort, and we all know that. And we've got one part of it, one crucial part, covered.
What's that?
That's the fans. I think back, and I think the one thing affected me. I think back to the stadium. I think back to all the things that happened there. I think about our fans and the fact that when I would go in that stadium, I don't care how cold it was. I don't care what the situation.
Has he been to the new stadium?
They were always there.
He's talking about RFK, right?
He's talking about RFK.
I felt like.
He's not been to the new house that Money built?
Miserable place.
He looks good, though.
Anybody else to try and play.
He sure does.
Doesn't
he
look like here.
He does not look burned out like
he
did 10 years ago.
I know football's important.
Do you think if he was to look at you and I, he would say this about you and I?
Now he would say, my God, what happened to you guys in a decade?
11 years later.
I want to say thanks to every single
Or do you think he just would be surprised that you and I are still alive?
He probably would be very surprised. Not that we're still on the air, but that we're alive.
Followed closely by the fact we're still on the air.
I look on the side and I catch a few guys, and I didn't even see you over there, Joe. We had guys here. I'll just share one little thing with you.
All right.
We played a Monday night game here, and I think it was 84. We got off to a horrible start, and I think we were like 1-2. And I'll just share this with you. I always talked to the team the night before. It was a Monday night game, and so when I walked out on that Monday night to the locker room before we go out, we always had the team prayer, and for some reason, I just said this. If any of you guys got anything to give the Washington Redskins, you need to give it tonight. We're in trouble. And I remember, you know, we had that prayer. And I stood back up, and I'm going to tell you what I witnessed. A lot of those Redskins had tears coming out of their eyes. And that's what it takes. I think...
It must have been high.
You got to have players like that.
Let's be honest.
I'm excited about getting started in a new relationship with all our players here, but...
a lot of the guys back on those teams were high.
There's some great guys that laid it on the line, and some of them are here today, and I'm looking forward to seeing them. So, anyway, the players, I just say to you, I think we're coaching and playing in a place where football is really important, and it's exciting to be a part of it.
You know, I forgot that this is the way Joe Gibbs is.
Yeah, yeah, and you know, and it's cool. It's fine.
I'm so excited about the guys that we
have. And I like what he said about forward, not backwards. Daniel, I don't like about that.
The most important thing for a player is, I think, is he wants somebody to help him to be at his best, and that's what we're going to try and do.
So
the coaches are all excited, and I just want to say it takes a great front office. Everybody here knows that. It takes great ownership. I'm looking forward to working to everybody here, the whole front office, the scouting department, and Benny. I'm looking forward to that relationship and us moving things ahead. And all of us, it takes great teamwork. Hey, it's not, hey, listen, it's not one person. It's not certainly I'm a small part of it. It's all of us together.
Oh, you're Josh and Joe.
It was the Redskins.
You're the man.
That's what it's going to take for us to win games. And so I'm...
Not to agree, to disagree.
I think
this is what this guy's always like. And, that's why we like him so
the
much.
The only one that we can say right now that's proven itself is our fans. The rest of us, we got to...
Are you kidding? Are you talking to me? I was going to burn my tickets 2 months ago.
I come here with the most humble spirit, I think, because, again, having said my part of this... We know, I really truly believe it is a small part. I'm anxious to be a part of this, and I'm coming into this with our eyes wide open. Here's the deal.
What?
We're going to play probably in, I think, one of the toughest divisions, if not the toughest division in football. When you stop and think about it, we're going to play Philly.
You know, he is good at this.
Like I'll give you know, this is where he's already got the eyes on the prize. Yeah. I like
he's real good at this.
I got home field advantage.
And I'm not busting his balls here. Where you get a coach who says right away, you know, we already know this speech, right?
Right.
Bill Parcells.
We're in a tough division.
I very first year they jump out, they're number one in defense. You know, you start worrying up here, we may not make a yard. So I got that.
What a crazy laugh, though.
Yeah, I like this, though.
And then, of course, you got the Giants and Tom Coughlin coming in there. That's going to be a whole new deal. They're excited.
Listen to this. This is typical Gibbs, right?
Yeah, he's got it. He's got it all together. I like it.
It's his day, and he's telling you now how good all the other teams are.
Yeah, I love it.
We're going to have to really be special to be able to play in this division and do what we want to do.
This is pretty comforting for Redskins fans, don't you think?
And don't you think also comforting the fact that,
I'm excited,
except for mentioning his name, there's been no Snyder thus far?
Right, absolutely.
Daniel?
I want to make a fast pace, try to be a good learner, dive back in here, get everybody here to kind of help us move this thing forward.
He needs to get his ginormous glasses back, though. His ginormous glasses.
I've probably been the most fortunate guy in the world to have the opportunities I have. And I look at this as a great opportunity, and I just, I got to tell you, the Lord has absolutely blessed me.
It's vintage Gibbs. It is exactly, I mean,
he always brings the J-Man into it.
It doesn't look like he's missed a beat, really.
Thank you.
All right.
So that's it? Okay, well done, Joe.
All right, Joe, welcome back.
Nice press conference. Well done.
Just what we expected. Now the questions.
Yes.
Bill, how and when did you decide to come back to Washington?
I think it was a long process for me. Pat and I and started talking. It was family-oriented. Other years, so there really hadn't been something there that obviously the times you talk to somebody. But I think...
I was reading about Gibbs today. That he's one of these nuts that started sleeping in the office.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that at one point, when he was really into sleeping in the office, that he would only communicate with his family via videotape because he would only be at home like one day a week.
Oh my God.
So he would leave a videotape saying, "Hey, it's me, Dad. I want to say, Johnny, how are you doing in school? And I want to say, Betty, how are you doing?" And it went bad when the videotapes that his family would give him were... "Hey, there was another project we needed you for that you weren't here for.
Oh, man.
There was another thing that happened. You missed another birthday." And that's when they stopped exchanging videotapes because he was so crazy sleeping in his office.
Well, now the kids are all grown, right?
Right.
Coming back here to all you media and have you guys call me all these nasty things. No, not true at all to that. I think the biggest adjustment for me, obviously the game has moved at a very fast pace. It's been a long time since I've been here. I can't wait to dive into the film room. I'm curious about all the new things that are going on the field. I also think we have the cap system already heavily trying to work real hard on figuring that out. Of course, we've got great people here along with Dan. They're going to figure that out. I think I've got great support there. That's a huge deal.
Yeah.
And I can tell you this, if you win with a core group of guys that really believe in the Redskins, and that's what we're going to try and do, preserve those guys in that group.
There's the message. Yeah. Right.
I got a steep learning curve.
We're going to win with a core group of guys.
And bury myself.
There are a lot of guys that swallowed hard when they heard that.
Get caught up. Obviously, I think I'm going to be way down the road.
I love the fact that when they're speculating, will Gibbs be able to relate to today's modern, effed up player?
Right.
They keep throwing out Dexter's name.
Sure.
They keep saying he coached Dexter Manley and John Riggins.
Yeah.
So, yeah,
really.
So he knows how to deal with the guys who are effed up.
He can handle anybody.
Let me mention one other thing there I left out. Obviously, the race team has been a huge deal for us. The race team's one of the biggest things that our family has. Obviously, it's our thing that we'll always on. And what happened, I think, is we started a process down there 12 years ago. And as I got back in it, when I left here, it was fun for me. It was exciting. It was thrilling. We were building a family business and a race team. And today, the reason why I feel so good about where I am today and why I do this.
The TV stations are doing, like, shots of all these former Redskins greats, all of them apparently stuck in the year 1985 wearing their Cosby sweaters. It's like high fidelity.
I'm the Cosby sweater.
Zippy and Tony and Bobby. We got a great management crew. So I think that's part of the answer is it kind of moved.
You say Zippy?
I guess he's got a guy on his racing team called Zippy.
The corner someplace and I knew the first time that J.D. said, "No, we're not doing that." That I was in trouble. I got to go someplace where they'll listen to me.
But, I love his laugh.
We have a great deal with Home Depot and Bob Nardelli and the guys down there.
All right, now he's just doing the plugs. All right, I think we've heard enough.
How do you not like this guy, all right?
Okay.
That's Joe Gibbs.
Yeah, we agree.
Fantastic. We agree. You've heard what you needed to hear. He's back being coach of the Washington Redskins. This is the national freaking story. And there he is. He's still talking, but now he's just talking junk. So there's the exclusive coverage. Not once were we mentioned.
No, we didn't get a thank you. I'm very surprised at that.
I'm looking at this now. If I was to recap this for anybody getting in their car, I'd say Joe Gibbs looks great. He said all the stuff that everybody's used to hearing him say about, like, we're in a tough division, the Giants are good.
My favorite thing that he said was you got to win with a core group of players, which is really, I think, you know, the thing about Joe Gibbs, for anybody that doesn't know this, is the way he coached. He is as tough as they come, but he won't do the tough talk. He'll say things like, we'll win with a core group of players, which is Joe's way of saying, you know, you're all on alert now.
Yep.
You know, you're on the bubble, boys.
And how about, let's just end this with an emergency shout-out. And really, this is an emergency shout-out to my man, Daniel!
Daniel, and that's good that it's not Mr. Snyder, it's
Daniel!
I think that says a lot.
That's right.
I like that, and maybe that we can, you know, who knows, we're overreading
it. I was talking with Daniel.
Daniel, little Daniel.
LD.
And really, what he should say is, Daniel, be a good boy, go into your office and shut the door.
So anyway, that's what's happening at Redskins Park. Glad we could bring that to you now. Listen, does the excitement end there on the Don and Mike show?
Does it?
No! No, goddammit! I think I should say that?
I think you should.
You think I should?
Yeah.
I think I might.
Okay.
We have an interview coming up with something that has something to do with Sammy Davis Jr.
Sammy!
Joining us live on the telephone will be the widow Davis.
Altavis?
Altavis Davis.
Altavis Davis.
Wow. Altavis Davis. As we can.
Wow.
You know, somebody show me the audience profile for this show.
We're all over the place.
Show me the audience profile for this freaking show.
Wow.
That we are going to go from this.
You probably should have. But I did not. You know, it was just something that.
Right. Okay. He's still going. We're going to go from that to Sammy Davis Jr.'s wife.
Very good.
When we come right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
That night was my son's birthday party. My wife invites the priest. He's always at the house.
Hey, Tony.
Hi, Don.
You like creme anglaise?
Hey, you bless it. I'll eat it.
She's not coming.
Who?
Grandma just called. Started crying and hung up.
She needs a purpose in life.
No, your mother is tougher than you think.
So what, no f***ing Didi now?
Hey!
Don and Mike, you know, I heard you were having a party, and you're trying to get me to go. But I'm not going to go if there's no f***ing ZD. Because, you know, it's just not going to happen. Thank you very much.
The Don and Mike Show. Moving faster than the speed of justice. The Don and Mike Show.
Say something not moving today. It's this Gibbs press conference. Listen to this night. This is still.
You can have a coach gone in this league right now.
We've been gone for 10 minutes of commercials. He's still going on. I'll tell you one thing.
He is psyched, though. He is excited to be here.
The new Joe Gibbs, as opposed to the old Joe Gibbs,
mm-hmm.
He has a psychotic laugh.
Yes, he does. He didn't laugh a lot when he was doing the regular standard press conferences.
He's laughed more in this last 40 minutes that we've been listening to him. Then he laughed maybe in the 11 years that he was the coach. And his laugh is very similar to that Burt Reynolds laugh.
Real high.
It's happened quite a few times. We're taping this and we're going to isolate him and put all of them together for you. Now, listen, this is still going on. So you hear that this is, you know.
To be a part of this. I knew he had. You know, treat me right, whatever, and whatever.
Buzz, just let me know when he mentions us.
Okay.
Let me know by the time he gets up to the point.
And he gives us the big thank you that we are so deserving.
And I wanted to say to Don and Mike, I'm sorry I gave you the evil eye at the Ronald McDonald House function.
We were hurt.
All those years ago. Mike, we have on the telephone now a man, a Hollywood producer.
Yes.
His name is Jimmy Richards.
Let me get Jimmy on with us now.
Jimmy.
Yes, he is.
Here he is.
Hi, Jimmy. How are you?
I'm doing wonderful. How are you doing?
Doing great.
We are doing great as well, sir. Now, here's the deal. This guy is looking for someone to be Sammy.
Sammy Davis Jr.
Right?
We're looking for two people to be Sammy Davis Jr.
You want the young Sammy and the older Sammy?
Nope, it's just two people.
Now, here's the specifications. Searching for African-American male, 21 to 50, to play and perform as Sammy Davis Jr. Actors should be 5'6", and be able to sing, dance, tap and jazz, act, and do impersonations. Vocal range, 2 octaves, low G to high G. And you're making, what, a movie? Is that what you're making?
No, actually, we have the first ever live stage show that's coming out entitled Mr. Bojangles, The Ultimate Entertainer.
Wow.
This is going to be a musical stage show that is going to travel casinos throughout the country.
Mr. Bojangles.
You got it.
Hold on just a second.
I don't understand why you're limiting it to African Americans.
Joining us,
I think I could do a good job.
Mike, here now, and we've talked about her endlessly, Altaviz.
Wow.
Altaviz. Lady Alto.
Wow, what a thrill. How are you, Altaviz?
I'm doing just fine.
Mike, why don't you say hi to her like Sammy used?
I do a Sammy impression. I mean, millions of people do.
No,
but
I don't do a Sammy impression, but we dance together.
Well, you know, I do, and I'll just say, hi, Altaviz. There you go. That's it. I'm giving you...
Mike, is this Mike?
This is Mike, and I've done Sammy Davis Jr., an impression of him, for years and years. Yeah.
Have a conversation.
Who can make this sunrise? Hi, Altaviz. How are you?
Fine, thank you.
But do you give it... Is it okay? Do you think it's all right?
Yes.
Okay. Well, hello?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Yes.
I just want to make sure I get her blessing, you know.
Interview her a little bit as
Sammy. Altaviz, are you excited about the project?
I am so excited about it because I think young kids and the people who have been there with him through the Copa, through Las Vegas, through everything else would be excited about this, I hope. And
what are your feelings?
Were you coughing, Buzz?
What are your feelings about disc jockeys that do impressions of your late husband?
Well, it depends who do the impressions of my late husband.
What about me? Am I okay?
You're pretty good.
Okay, thank you very much.
Pretty
I appreciate
good.
It.
Not the best white guy doing Sammy you've ever heard?
Well, you know, there's another white guy that does him.
Who's that?
He's a comedian.
Oh, okay.
That
still does it?
Crystal.
Billy Crystal. Yeah, that's
now,
right. And Billy Crystal
you're
and all
better
them.
Than Billy Crystal.
Thank you, Don. I appreciate
Billy
that.
Crystal does a great Muhammad Ali.
Yeah, and he I remember when he on Saturday Night Live, he used to do Sammy Davis Jr.
So, Altaviz, may I call you Lady Alto?
Of course you may.
Lady Alto.
Thank you.
Darling. Lady A. Yeah. L.A.
That's great.
Where are you living now? Are you living in Beverly Hills, darling?
No, I don't live in Beverly Hills now.
Where do you live?
I go back and forth from New York to L.A., but I don't live in Beverly Hills in my old house that we lived on the house on the hill.
I know that when they made that Rat Pack movie that Don Cheadle played Sammy Davis.
Yeah, what did you think of Don Cheadle's performance in that whole movie?
And also in Ocean's 11, he played, you know, although they were different roles.
Well, I think that was with Frank and Dean and Sammy sang EO 11. It was Ocean's 11.
Right, exactly.
With the three of them, and they loved each other so much as friends. They were pals.
Who did... Now, I know this is an impossible question, but I'll ask, who did Sammy get along with better, Frank or Dean or...
Peter Lawford
or Joey Bishop?
Right.
Sammy got along really with everybody, and Frank helped him at one time with something going, I forgot, I was just a kid, as Frank would call me, the kid, The Sammy always helped Frank, and Frank helped Sammy, you know, go out and sing and do and help other people.
So that movie with, you know, just based on the movie and the recent film that was out about the Rat Pack, the impression of that film, the way they communicated it, was that the relationship between Frank and Sammy was more special than anybody else
in
the Rat Pack.
They were brothers.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Okay.
Wow.
So you agree with that?
Yes.
All right.
They were brothers.
Lady Alto, if I may ask you perhaps an off-color question, but Frank was known for his dalliance with...
For his what?
He would dally with lovely ladies of fancy flesh. And,
Didn't they all?
That's what I was going to ask you. Was there ever one trip where, you know, Sammy would come back from being out with the guys and you would know it? Or did he not do that? Or did you accept it? Or were you with him all the time? Or what was the deal?
No, I wasn't with him all the time, but I invited all his old girlfriends one time to the house and had them for dinner.
Wow.
So you were cool with
that. Now, do you mean, did you kill them and put them in the oven, or did you actually serve them?
No, I cooked beef stroganoff, and that was my thing, and then I invited them all over and had all their husbands or boyfriends to come over later.
Wow. Are you optimistic, seriously? I mean, of all the people, when you talk about Sammy Davis Jr. and the level of talent that he had,
Sammy.
Do you really think you'll be able to find somebody who can do him justice?
Well, there's a lot of young people out there. I think we will find someone out there that can do it. I think...
Alta Vizla, Lady Alto, I must tell you that my friend Mike, who I've been working with for 18 years, done Sammy the whole time, cracked me up. Now, I know Mike is not African-American. He is between 21 and 50.
Yes.
He's not 5'6". He is taller than that.
And yeah, I'm 5'11", actually.
And I know that you're probably really, you know, going to be hard to waver on this whole black-white thing.
Yeah, and I'm an Irish guy, and I look kind of Irish.
But just give it a try, Mike. Just
Mr. Bojangles.
Sounds very good.
Yes. So you're telling me there's a chance.
Would you consider... A white guy.
Of course.
So you would consider a white guy.
I'll be out there for the auditions. Just give me the information.
Now, do you have an eye patch, Mike?
Yeah, I could find one, absolutely. But, you know, you don't need the eye patch. You know, I mean, that was only a brief period in his history that he wore the eye patch. But maybe if I was using it for...
the eye patch only because he had a car accident.
Yeah, he had the car accident. Right. And then it was replaced by the glass eye later on in his life. You
That's
know?
Right.
All right. Well, you know, I will. I don't know, Rob. Thank you, but I'm very, very excited about this. I really am.
Well,
I'm a big fan.
I am very excited about it, and I think that I hope other people will be excited about it, and I think that to have it enjoyed by other people and to share it. And I wanted to share it because Sammy shared his life with so many people.
Lady Alto, let me just ask you this. This guy, and I don't know him from a box on the side of the road. Yes, this guy, Jimmy Richards. Are we sure that he is above board? Are we sure that he's, you know, in like you know, I'm sure you...
Our motto in Hollywood is trust no one. You know that.
And... You know, here you are, the beautiful Lady Alto with a lifetime of memories with Sammy, and all of a sudden, this guy comes along and he wants to do, hey, I'm Slicky Boy Jimmy Richards.
We don't know that, but we're just saying, you think everything's on the up and up?
Well, I think, I hope it is, and I think it is, and I think we'll do very well, and I have a good team group with me, the Barrett LaRota Group. And I have a good...
Do you have paper on this guy? I mean, you got a signed contract with this guy?
Yes, we have talked, and I have a good advisor and a friend called Tony Francis.
Hey, hold on just a second. I'll rough him up for you. Hold on a second. Let me make sure. He's on
another line.
Hey, Jimmy. Hey, dude.
This is Jimmy.
Jimmy, dude.
Hello, John and Mike.
Don't treat Lady Alto wrong.
You do her right, man. You understand?
Hey, listen. I will go on record as saying I am honored to have be associated with Alta Vista Davis, and I she's a true friend, and she's a very, very, very sweet. I mean, how many guys, how many women do you know that invite their husbands, ex-girlfriends over to their house for dinner?
He's a slick guy. You got a point there, Jimmy.
Hold on, Jimmy. Alta Vista, I realize we've just met, but I must tell you, I'm an astute judge of character.
Who is this?
This is Don.
Don and Mike, we're back on with you, Alta Vista.
This is Don now.
Okay.
You simply must dump this Jimmy Rick. he is not to be trusted.
You don't trust him, Don, as he's...
I do not.
Are you seeing a red flare?
I can smell his cheap cologne through the telephone.
Well, we'll see if Alta Vista can get some of her advisors to replace this guy.
Okay.
Now, if you're interested, if you're listening to this and you're thinking, hey, I am a black guy... I am between 21 and 50.
People tell me all the time I'm as good as Sammy.
And I'm 5'6".
Two octaves.
Then go to www.MrBojanglesAuditions.com.
Mm-hmm.
And who will be doing the actual selection of the various Sammys?
Well, they're having auditions in Chicago first. Then they're going to Chicago and L.A. And we're going to just find this out.
All right, and you will you have any say in that at the end when it comes down to the wire? When they
when
get
it comes
some...
down to the wire, I won't go to the beginning.
Right.
Go to the end.
Lady Alto, if I may be so brazen.
Thank you, so call me for that.
Only the most love and respect. I remember when Sammy would come on TV, and I don't do the impression. Mike doesn't
even come out and talk about Lady Alto.
My beautiful wife, Alto V.
Alto V. It's a beautiful name. I mean, I've never heard that
high
name.
High vision and high view.
It's beautiful. I love that.
Lady Alto V. Would it be all right if you took our famous celebrity sex quiz?
Okay.
All right. Let me try it. All right.
We have
how many questions total on the sex quiz?
14 questions.
Only take a moment. And who was the last celebrity, the big celebrity to take you?
How many questions do I have to answer?
It's 14, and they're all just yes or no, most of them. And I think, Robbie, who was the last person of importance to take this test?
It's so important. Tim Conway.
Tim Conway was the last person. You know Tim Conway, right, Alta Beast?
Tim Conway, because he was on Carol Burnett Show.
Right. Yeah, right. Absolutely. He was the last one to take the sex quiz.
Now, here we go. Alta Beast Davis. Lady Alto.
Yes.
Have you ever been in a three-way or enjoyed group sex?
No.
No? All right, very good.
Lady Alto, have you ever had sex while menstruating?
No.
No? Lady Alto, have you ever had a lesbian experience?
I've seen it, but I haven't had it.
Okay. You got to give her a no for that.
Have you ever made love in your parents' home, Lady Alto?
No.
No. Have you, Altavis Davis, ever enjoyed hot interracial sex?
Interracial?
Yes, with a...
Yeah, I understand now.
Gotcha.
No.
No.
That's
a no. Very good.
Sorry.
Oh, yes.
It's a yes.
Oh, it's changed to a yes.
All right, very good.
Lady Alto, have you ever J-O'd in front of others?
What's that mean?
Have you ever pleasured yourself digitally
in front of other people?
Oh, no.
No, you have not. Have you ever had sex in a public place?
No.
No. Have you ever been filmed or photographed while having sex?
No.
Incidentally, I'm, we don't judge anybody by their answers, but Lady Alto, I'm guessing the slime ball on the other line,
yes.
Probably yes to all.
Probably yes right down the line.
Yeah. Lady Alto?
Yes.
Have you ever had sex in the no-no?
What? I don't know what.
You know, where food comes out.
No.
No. Oh. All right, no.
Lady
All right.
Alto, can I believe you on that?
Yes, sex when food comes out.
Lady Alto, do you swallow?
Food?
Do you swallow?
No.
No.
Oh, my God.
She's saving up to be one of the purest contestants ever on the sex quiz.
Four more questions. Lady Alto, have you gotten your jerk on today?
Not yet.
Not yet.
Not yet. Have you ever had sex in a car?
Yeah, when I can't know how to put gas in it.
No, come on. You have to have had sex in a car.
Not with a car.
No, in a car.
Inside a car.
Not with a car.
Inside of a car.
Uh-uh.
Really? Have you ever had a one-night stand or sex with a stranger?
Never with a stranger.
Yes. And finally, Lady Alto, to the nearest 10, 50, 100, or 1,000, what do you estimate your total number of partners to have been up to this moment, sexual partners?
Up to this moment?
You can give us just an estimate.
You know,
it's only been probably four.
Four. Buzz, I believe.
Four.
Really, we have one of the purest participants ever in the sex quiz. What are her totals?
Altavis?
Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Saint Altavis with two yes answers and four partners.
Wow.
Congratulations,
Altavis. One of the best ever. Farther away from wrestler Diamond Dallas Page, who scored off the
chart. Do I get a diamond for this?
No. not that I don't believe you, but I find it, as a Sammy fan,
I believe her completely.
I believe her.
hard to believe that Sammy would be married to such a prude.
Why, lady
Alto, you mean that your glorious chocolate ebony lips have never touched the lips of another woman? Never?
Yeah, I kiss women.
That's a lesbian experience.
Well, not if it's,
hello,
not...
I kiss them when I say hello and I go out to dinner.
It's like kissing your mom.
But Lady Alto, have you ever kissed lip on lip?
Huh?
Have you ever kissed another woman lip on lip, like not kissing her cheek, but kissing her lips?
Yeah, but not...
Ah. No, now you're putting... Lady Alto, you're putting words in her mouth. It was a simple, friendly greeting kiss.
Mm-hmm.
I agree that she's pure as the driven snow.
I do, too.
Well, Lady Alto, it's been a pleasure chatting with you. The website is Mr. Bojangles, the ultimate... I'm sorry, MrBojanglesAuditions.com.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And is Mr. Bojangles the ultimate entertainer?
The ultimate entertainer.
I hope you find somebody that's that can even come halfway to Sammy.
With the help of my group, with the Barrett LaRoto group, and with Jimmy Richards.
Yeah, watch that guy.
Yeah, you watch him.
Watch him?
Yeah, watch him. And, oh, hey, how do you feel about Joe Gibbs?
Okay, listen, just the other night, what's his name, Mr. Griffith, what's his name that was on David Letterman the other night? I don't know, he wants to do Sammy.
But, right on.
Perfect.
Okay, thank you, Alzo.
All right, Alzo Beast, good luck with that. Thanks for coming on the show.
Okay, Mike, thank you so much.
Say goodbye to her, Sammy.
And I'll say goodbye to Sammy. Alzo Beast, farewell, Alzo Beast.
Thank you.
I love you.
Oh, thank you so much.
There you go.
Alzo Beast Davis.
Very nice.
Thank you, Alzo Beast.
Okay, bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
There she is. Hey, are you there, Slicky Boy?
John and Mike, wow.
Now, you listen.
You guys, Jesus, Mary and
Rob,
St. Joseph.
I still may have my Sammy cigarette butt that I
really?
Got at the Greater Hartford Open. Like
man,
movie.
I
listen,
tell
you. You bastard, you watch out now. We're watching you, okay?
Listen, you guys watch all you want.
You got your plug-in.
I love doing these types of interviews where you're talking about a play and it goes to a sex quiz.
Yeah, well, she was very, I tell you, probably the purest contestant ever on the sex quiz.
And I don't believe
Altavis is really a doll, and we appreciate you guys even wanting to talk to us about the show. It's really it's a great opportunity.
Well, we love
doing this on Sammy, and it's two Sammys. That's the funny part. Somebody asked me, why are you guys doing two Sammys?
Yeah, you're way too slick.
The real reason is...
I'll just pick up the phone and tell him thanks.
We'll never know. Yeah,
tell him I'll plug his website. It's www.MrBojanglesAuditions.com.
And in her day, she was a sexy lady.
Yeah. We'll
plug your website. Good luck. Well, don't screw with Alto.
I just picked the phone up from Rob's hand. They wouldn't worry about Alto V's Davis.
I like some of the names she was mentioning with her management group. Sounds like some of these guys, you know. Hey, hey, I understand you've been giving Alto V's a hard time.
Yeah, right. See you at the bottom of big. Alto V's.
Alto V's. Well, that was fun.
Mm-hmm.
We've been talking about her for years.
Too sweet.
Alto V's.
My wife, Alto V's.
My wife, Alto V's. And, you know, the sad thing is that it came down to the last Sammy I did was the one where, like, at the end, where he says, may I have a glass of water?
Alto
V's. And I do still have that cigarette butt somewhere. But, Rob, I was...
In a world where radio was strictly forbidden, one man found a way to bring good news to his people.
There is his buzz.
Me. He made it up.
I was just going to tell Rob with his little thing he wrote for me. I wasn't going to ask her if I should run to the tanning booth, Rob Spiewak. Thank you very much.
That's a funny joke.
It's a funny. Okay,
all right.
There you go. There's the arbiter.
Hey, I stand by that.
I know. I sure know you do. You stand there with boots on. All right.
I do. And Mike, here you go. Thanks, Charlie.
Is that a picture of Alto V's?
Alto V's with Sam. With Sammy.
Oh, she was a hottie. I forgot that.
Yeah.
That's right.
I remember, like, on Laughing or something. She'd be on Laughing, mm-hmm. and it was always like, wow, it was pretty hot.
Yeah. She had a great rack, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, you come by.
I think she might have been a showgirl.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like that build.
Buzz, your lead story today
is Liza Minnelli's husband didn't make it to court. He's still hiding at Jim Neighbor's house.
Well, wow,
it just gets better, doesn't it?
It sure does.
It just gets better. You better get out that copy of You Are the Sunshine of My Life. All right, stay tuned, everybody.
Stay tuned. For news and comments coming up on the Don and Mike Show.
That was very
professional.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
a new year. And time for you to get a new wireless company. Switch to Singular. Take advantage of the amazing deals Singular is offering right now.
You will be delighted with Singular's rollover minutes. I know someone who I'm in love with who's delighted with it.
Wasn't she delighted? She was talking about it just the other day.
Yeah, my wife was doing like a special commercial for Singular.
Only Singular has rollover. Only Singular lets you keep your number and your unused anytime minutes. Something that's important to people like Frida.
Sign up for Family Talk. I think this would... I think the thing that got her going was she heard us doing this commercial. She signed up for Family Talk.
Sure.
And allegedly, Singular will give you 500 bonus rollover minutes to share. Add a line for $9.99 per line per month or select plans starting at just $39.99 a month.
New year, new wireless company, new script, same number. Make the switch to Singular. Call today. 1-866-SINGULAR. Log on to Singular.com or visit any Singular wireless store.
And just the good people at Singular, should you make my life a lot easier if you just call my wife. Restrictions apply. I see any Singular wireless store for details.
WJFK, the Don and Mike Show.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
What's the word from Planet Crackpot?
The Don and Mike Show.
What's the word from Planet Crackpot?
They like their cruelty the way they like their women.
Right.
Naked. Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
Yeah, now
what's
that
the
is
word
tight.
From Planet Crackpot?
Time for Buzz's News. Buzz brought to you by Veramax Sexual Pleasure Performance Enhancer.
Someone called for a doctor.
Doctor developed, clinically tested. Veramax works. You get it at Rite Aid, GNC, other select retailers. Try it today. Veramax, one AAA try. VMAX, tomorrow on the show, we're going to be watching Joe Ardinger's circa 1950s videotape. Again, the title of it is
The ABCs of Sex Ed.
Sex Ed for...
Trainables.
For tards. That's tomorrow. Plus, we've been told she won't stand us up. And we'll take a beautiful lady at her word, mm-hmm. Nancy Davis from CBS.
Nancy James.
Nancy James. Let's say Nancy Davis.
You did.
I've got
Nancy James.
Sammy on the brain.
Nancy James Jr.
Yes. Jim Nance, who we call Nancy James
right.
because he's such a woman. He'll be on the show tomorrow. Oh, we just had Altavis Davis on, and she is definitely a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And Joe Gibbs before that, and he wasn't. The boys in the back who are cutting up the tape of the Joe Gibbs press conference.
They're getting some good laughs, some good psycho laughing.
What we're going to do is we might not have it by the end of today's show, but we're going to have on a continuous loop all of the times that Joe Gibbs did his new high-pitched laugh.
Very exciting.
Also, we were going to have all of the times he referred to current Redskins owner Daniel Snyder as either Dan or Daniel.
Right.
And all of the times that he referred to former Redskins owner Jack Kent Cook as Mr. Cook.
Ah, very good. That's very exciting.
So that's some in-depth analysis.
That's
and now here's Buzz.
Hi, Don and Mike. Liza Minnelli was in divorce court yesterday, but her girlish husband never showed. Liza's lawyers argue that the divorce proceedings cannot go forward until they've had a chance to depose, ask questions of, estranged husband David Guest. But Guest's lawyers say he's still too disabled to make it, what with all the beatings he supposedly took from Liza months ago.
Oh, pretty funny just thinking of her slapping him around.
So Guest is still hiding out at Jim Nabors' house in Hawaii. Quoting Liza's lawyers, oh, here's Jim Nabors now, singing to David Guest, I think.
We pulled out a new one for you from our best of Jim Nabors. We've not gone with the old standard.
I think listening to Jim Nabors sing makes me laugh.
All the games people play now.
And it's interesting because earlier this week we had a guy on who was discussing cornholing.
Yeah. Does anybody ever sing like Jim Nabors?
Does anybody ever suck a deal like Jim Nabors? Does anybody ever get hepatitis like Jim Nabors? I say no. Anyway, so that's where David Guest is hiding
is at Jim Nabors' house in Hawaii, where Jim grows macadamia nuts.
Ah, yes, those are great nuts.
Quoting Liza's lawyers, either he should be here and be deposed or withdraw his actions. And Liza's lawyers want Guest to undergo a medical exam to prove that he's too weak to make the flight.
And don't forget that stuff that I had earlier that David Guest's attorney is still saying that, that Liza has some disease.
A medical condition.
That she gave to David.
Yeah, and they won't say what the disease is, but they don't want to go on with the divorce trial until Liza Minnelli has a blood test.
To confirm that she has the condition.
And imagine that. You poke a needle in her arm and just out comes like Prego. Prego and heroin.
Mmm, delicious.
Vodka.
The sky is still blue, and the woman who claimed to have lost a multi-million-dollar lottery ticket has come clean. The woman who calls herself Alicia Battle, even though that's not really her name, now admits she also lied about the lottery ticket. The 40-year-old woman cried again as she confessed today.
See you in Toledo, you stupid whore.
Amen.
She's now dropped her lawsuit against the real winner and apologized to the real winner. But Alicia, who's been convicted of credit card fraud, says she really did buy a lottery ticket and that she really did lose it. It just wasn't the Mega Millions ticket worth $162 million. In the New York Daily News this morning, a word about what the Martha Stewart jury pool is going through. The paper says...
Boy, how'd you like to be swimming in there?
Boy, I bet you find hairs in that pool.
Do you think it's a suit's optional?
Of course it is. But the paper says its sources describe the jury questionnaire as 57 pages long, and that some people are taking up to 5 hours to fill in the blanks. The source says it's almost like an SAT quiz.
Well, Martha wouldn't have it any other way.
Although some questions are multiple choice, others require essay answers. The questions include whether they've seen the TV movie about Martha starring Cybill Shepherd and what they thought about
it. Robbie, join me in the jury pool.
Come over to this side of the pool. It's a little warmer, if you know what I mean.
Now, Marcia.
Marcia, Martha.
Marcia, Marcia, Marcia. Martha, is that a Tootsie Roll? Martha.
Something's floating in the pool, Martha.
In the jury pool.
Potential jurors are also asked if they ever bought anything off MarthaStewart.com and how they felt about the product once they received it.
Sounds a little anal to me. Little anal.
Sounds to me like Martha's got gas in the jury pool.
Yeah. She's blowing her own bubbles. Oh, that's some jury pool.
Martha Stewart.
You want to know what the cops found at Michael Jackson's place?
Oh, hold on a second.
Just enjoying the bubbles from Martha?
No, she's having some type of a feminine reaction.
Oh, my.
Here.
Get her out. Oh, the water's turning red.
Look here. Oh, it's soup.
Nasty. So you want to know what the cops found at Michael Jackson's place. I want to know, and the news media is trying to find out. Reporters have asked the judge to unseal the court records on the search at Neverland. Those records would include the reasoning behind the search warrant and a list of the items confiscated. But the judge also has to consider a request from Jacko's lawyers. They want a gag order on the case.
Gag order.
Yeah, yeah. Ironic, ain't it?
Jury pool, gag order. I love legal terminology.
Get in Michael Jackson's jury pool.
This is jury pool. Oh.
And then you start gagging.
What's that doing? Floating? Oh, we better get a gag order in here.
Michael has two pools now.
Mm-hmm.
Because Michael has moved. He loaded up the truck and moved to Beverly Hills, that is. He set up residence with his three kids in a $20 million mansion there on 2 acres in one of the most exclusive sections of the city.
Oh, yeah.
The home has 9 bedrooms, 10 baths, 2 swimming pools, a theater, and a tennis court. And it overlooks a children's park.
So just in case, you know, a lazy Saturday afternoon, he's got a couple of seconds, and he wants to go outside, work his man a little bit.
Sure.
Hey, look, there's little Johnny out there.
All he has to do is find a little amusement park right across the street.
There you go.
And his move, by the way, could mean a change of venue for the trial to Los Angeles. On 60 Minutes, Jocko said he no longer considers Neverland his home because the police search, in his words, tainted it.
He's a taint.
Taint.
Another
taint.
Ironic word.
Mm-hmm.
You've no doubt heard that the British government has banned its country's own newspapers from talking about the accusation that Prince Charles has been actively bisexual.
Now, that's very communistic of them, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Oh, wait till you hear now.
Because, I mean, before you even get into the story...
Right.
You have to, and they know it too. The people of Britain know
sure,
this too.
Know.
That all of these, the Queen and the Prince, is all just made up junk.
It's phony stuff. It's fantasy land.
It's made up. The guy, Tony Blair, is the president.
But his handmaiden,
Prime Minister.
That's not fantasy.
That's true.
I heard that was an eyewitness account.
Now, the Brits have also banned newspapers, mostly from France, that have been writing about the accusation. 15 foreign newspapers have been banned in all, nearly all of them European. a valet for the royal family for 11 years, says there was a sexual incident between a servant and an important member of the royal family.
European, I'm a grinning.
The valet also says he was raped by that same servant.
Whoa.
The palace
calls... Who was raped? Prince Charles?
No, the valet says he was raped by... by the guy that he allegedly saw with Prince Charles, apparently.
Oh, really?
So the guy that
so
was
Prince
doing...
Charles, he was raped by Prince Charles's handmaiden?
I guess that would be the description, yeah.
So the guy who was a willing lover to Prince Charles then went out and raped another guy.
That's what the other guy is saying, as a matter of fact.
Man, a lot of ass play in Buckingham Palace.
I was watching one of those Law and Orders. You know, that's worse than CSI.
Mm-hmm.
Because at least with CSI, there's only two of them.
Right.
Right? And you know, the one's in Miami and one's in Las Vegas.
And then...
With the Law and Order, you got the one that's got the guy with the old face. Jerry...
Orbach.
And then you've got the other one that's got...
Sam Waterston.
And then the other one's got the guy like with the receding hairline.
Carol O'Connor.
And the girl that might be cute, but she's got kind of a butch...
Cameron Manheim.
No, that's the practice.
Oh, you just said girl that might be cute.
But with all of the Law and Orders, and now they're all in reruns, at some time on some channel, Law and Order is always on.
Yes, and I had a Law and Order point, and but now that we're talking about
did
it...
Did Carol O'Connor throw you?
Buckingham Palace.
Orbach.
What?
Jerry Orbach getting raped.
CSI, not... Worse than CSI. Your point was about too many things going on.
It was a plot...
Jim Nabors.
Shuri Pool.
Macadamia nuts.
Killing me. It was some plot that could have been plucked right out of today's headlines.
Gag order. Tootsie Roll.
Right there, right on Law and Order, on one of the 10 times a week that it's on.
Well, Buckingham Palace calls all of these accusations ludicrous.
Ludicrous.
Oh, now, you know, I'm coming so...
Everybody
close.
Stop.
I'm coming out. Don't do that. Shut up.
Everybody stop. Don's thinking.
If that's the case, this is what this show is sound like every day. If we just stop for me to think. Jesus, now I'll never remember.
I just thought of another great guy in Law and Order is that guy Fred Thompson. Give my best to your good lady.
Oh. Yeah, my good lady. Ross? That's good. My good lady. Prince Charles.
And also,
where's his handmaiden?
Richard Belzer, who really needs a makeover.
Yeah.
Really bad.
Yeah, he needs one of those sandblasters for his cheeks.
And who is it Ice Cube? Is yes, Ice Cube right? or Ice-T yeah. that's on that?
One of those ice guys.
Ice Cube.
It was something like...
Are you still looking for the point with Law and Order?
Yes!
Okay, all right.
Yes! Let me turn the microphones off while I think for a moment.
Don's thinking.
No, I'm kidding. Yeah, move on. I'll do it while we're talking.
Okay.
It'll come back to me.
Goofy is suing Disney for $300,000. A guy who played Goofy on the company's cruise ship says he was injured when a curtain came crashing down on his head. The curtain contains weights to keep it straight, and Eric Ford says the costume was defective in that it didn't protect him. In fact, he says the way it was designed, he couldn't see the curtain or anything else for that matter. He also says the stagehand who lowered the curtain was negligent and that there were no markers on the stage to indicate where he should stand.
Mr. Isaac Smith here. Over.
Smith, we got a problem. I need to have you talk about that goofy on the cruise ships on the big red boat.
Working without your go-ahead, we've already had him thrown overboard and believe he is now drowned and dead, sir. Over.
Excellent job. Smith, you're doing a great job. I'll need you to put on those Mickey shorts and come up to my office. I've got something special for you.
Sir, I just got the news that in the Magic Kingdom today, apparently a youngster fell and dislocated a shoulder and also perhaps knocked out one of his eyes.
Were there any witnesses at all?
The answer is they've already been taken care of, sir, but the boy, what about the boy?
The boy, have the boy, give him 2 free e-tickets, send him on his way, and get up to my office as soon so you can see my fabulous goofy penis puppet.
When I come up there, sir, I want you naked, wearing just your ostrich boots.
And I want you to put some mouse ears where my food comes out. Thank you, Smith. I love you.
I love you, sir, but the ass is the ass.
I know. That's right. Yeah. That's not Smith talking.
You're right. Hi, Mike.
Hi, Don.
Smith out.
Bye.
Smith and Eisner. Well, this Eric Ford, who played Goofy, says he's had disabling injuries to his neck and back for the last 3 years, not to mention the mental anguish and the loss of his enjoyment of life.
Oh, what a shame.
Yeah.
And he was an Imagineer before that.
He sounds like Frida. He took all the joy out of it for me.
The joy and the boy.
The boy.
What about the joy?
When a Norwegian reporter prepared to do a story on teenaged girls selling sex on the internet, he expected to find perverts and undercover cops posing as teenage girls. What he found was teenage girls selling sex on the internet.
Yep.
He found 16-year-old girls selling sex to men 20 years older.
Yep.
Quoting one girl, "We want $300 for sex, and we will do anything. Anything but anal, I mean." End quote.
"John, baby, how's it going?"
She says she does it for the money and the excitement.
She works hard for the money.
Uh-huh.
So hard for the money.
Watchdog groups are advising parents in Norway to keep a close eye on what their kids do online.
Bad girl.
Toot, toot.
That
beep, beep.
Good anywhere.
So sex in Norway makes me think of that great Beatles song, Norwegian Wood.
I'm looking for some hot stuff, baby. This evening. Some hot stuff tonight. Love to love you, baby.
In Central Florida, a local TV anchorwoman on a news channel has been arrested for shoplifting. Elizabeth Jean Talbot was spotted at Albertson's taking a fruit tray and some Dunhill cigarettes.
Three-name person.
Yeah.
And it's a grocery store.
Right.
Albertson's. So right. She's stealing from a grocery store.
A fruit tray and some Dunhill cigarettes.
There's the conflict. She's conflicted.
Yes.
Fruit tray, cigarettes. Of course. Anchor lady.
Right.
Shoplifter. Conflict abounds.
Oh, big time. She was stopped at the front door by employees who then called the sheriff's office. Total value of her shopping spree, apparently, we had $23. The anchor lady is now out on $250 bond.
Why did she have to pick Jack's store, though? God.
Most anchor people know this is not a good value.
Jack Albertson.
Chico,
hey, Chico.
I get you.
That's for the old people in the audience. Charlie. Charlie, we're making bubbles, Charlie.
Charlie, nobody's watching.
It's Jack Albertson.
Charlie.
This is a sick moment, though.
That's good.
From Charlie and the Chocolate Factory.
Grandpa, this banana is fantastic.
Ooh. Charlie. Charlie. In your wildest dreams, you could not imagine the marvelous surprises that await you.
Grandpa.
Ooh. Charlie, you got it.
Whee!
Have a shooting star.
Okay, hold on.
WPGC.
Two in a row.
WPGC.
Two in a row.
Oh, man, the original theme to Chico and the Man. That's great. All because Buzz mentioned Albertson's department store. Or grocery store.
Right.
Right. Chico.
I think one of the best TV themes ever written.
Right.
Chico.
Chico.
Don't be discouraged. And he ain't so hard.
Great theme. Crappy show.
Awful show. Even the ones that were supposed to be funny, never funny.
Never funny.
Chico and the Man, never funny. Listen, Sanford and Son, funny.
Right.
Always.
Right.
Chico and the Man,
not funny.
Funny, never. Funny, never.
Courage, Dan Rather, as they remove the spots from
and
their face.
Buzz, hold on. We have to break before you talk about Dan Rather's age spots.
Yes.
I just wanted to give a celebrity shout-out.
Uh-huh.
Seems it's day for these has-been celebrities today. Jose Feliciano, who sang that song.
Yes, still performing.
And his favorite color, of course,
is
corduroy.
Corduroy, thank you.
And we'll be talking about Dan Rather's age spots.
Yes, we will.
Can I hear that? We come right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Gosh, I hate to interrupt. It's all been so incredibly fascinating and entertaining and instructive. Really, the time has just flown by.
The Don and Mike Show.
They like whole, not whole. Don and Mike.
Let's see, a couple of internal things here before we get back to Buzz and the news and the comments. This is Petty. I'll keep this very brief. You know, we were canned on WYSP in Philadelphia last year.
That's right.
And the thought around that radio station was that as soon as we were gone, that it was going to be, ratings bonanza.
Yeah, they were going to hit the roof.
How are they doing? You get rid of us. Well, let's see. Last year, the winter, the fall ratings book, when we were on the same time last year, WYSP had a 4.5.
Okay.
The ratings that just came out today,
yes,
for the they have a 4.3.
Mm.
So they're actually doing worse
Yeah, without us.
Without
yeah,
us.
Which
course.
Is petty, but we're petty guys, and we had to mention that, and
there you go.
Hallelujah.
Now, Altavis Davis will never be on this show again. Not because Altavis Davis does not like us. We don't know. Uh-huh. Rob received an angry message moments ago from the management of Altavis Davis. I call this my next witness, Rob Spiewak.
Rob, they were very angry.
They were very upset, and they said that what I led them to believe would be a respectable interview turned into a series of sex questions. And I'll perhaps give them a call back tomorrow because I wouldn't want to cut off that source of has-beens. Or in perhaps her case never
That's
was.
Crazy. Right. She seemed very comfortable with it, and even the Slicky Boy we talked to was excited about
yes,
it.
Yes, I would think so, and we gave their website a plug.
Now they're insane.
And it's funny how they didn't complain until after they got their plug.
Yeah, isn't that
funny?
Nice?
Yeah.
Yes.
Hey,
Bob and Mike.
Well, those are not age spots they've removed from Dan Rather's face. The CBS anchorman had some basal cells removed, this week.
Those taste great in a spaghetti sauce.
He's now resting at home. The spots on the 72-year-old were apparently from too much sun. They were not cancerous yet.
Now, I've got some wonderful pasta here, and I've got a little sauce. Now, Dan, put your face over here. Now, who wants some of this? Who wants some of this on their pasta?
There you go. Scrape off the basil cells,
little oregano,
and you basil cells.
Yeah. You'll have that.
I'm Dan Rather, CBS News. Shave my face.
Mmm. Better if you grate your own.
That's good sauce.
Yeah. The spots were removed as a preemptive measure. About 800,000 Americans get basal cell cancer each year.
These are all the sounds that I'm taking these things off Dan Rather's face.
Some of the basal cells,
they were tough.
Don't go as easy as the others.
Get that.
It's another person at the door.
They tried everything.
When you get right down to it, you got to do it this way.
They tried everything. He's going to need some time to heal. Oh, we got a bleeder here.
Hi, I'm Cameron Gray, Operations Director. Don't blame me.
Okay. Get them all out of here right now. Get them out.
Everyone leave now.
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 Helicopter.
Go, take them away in the helicopter.
No, they're not, Mike. They're getting in cars.
They are.
There goes the helicopter. They're getting... Look at them.
Well, the network says Gunga Dan is expected to be back at the anchor desk next week.
Gunga Dan.
Okay, I promised yesterday to keep you posted on new products, like the new Arnold beer. But I'm sorry to report we are all out of turkey and gravy soda.
Goddamn.
A very small soda company that makes very tasty beverages came out with a new flavor last fall that proved to be very popular in the states where it was sold, namely Michigan and the state of Washington.
What am I going
to
do now?
Jones's turkey and gravy soda flew off the shelves.
He's so thirsty.
So the company says it'll make more this fall and this time offered across the country.
I'm ready to barf just hearing about it.
The company is so...
yeah, there we go.
So pleased with the response, it also says it will donate all of the proceeds from that flavor to Toys for Tots.
I like mine on pistachio ice cream.
Oh, that's delicious. Especially when it forms those little ice crystals.
Try it with basil cells. Ozzy Osbourne says he's giving up all-terrain vehicles. Ozzy checked himself out of the hospital on Christmas Eve wearing a neck brace and a sling. That's right.
What was that, love? What, you want to tell mommy something?
Sean, let me see your cow titties.
Oh, what do you want to see, love?
Your cow titties. Substitute Ozzy and keep that on the air. That's
yeah, it is.
Let me see your mams. Can I see your mammies? Put them in my mouth. Sharon.
Back on December 8th, he turned over an off-road vehicle, fracturing his collarbone, 8 ribs, and a neck vertebra. The 55-year-old posed for pictures and then talked with a British newspaper about it afterward. Quoting him, I'm Ozzy Osbourne rock and roller, but I can barely set foot outside my own front door.
That's
He's
funny.
In sad shit.
And they didn't get it on tape, right?
No.
They didn't get
well,
that
if they did, we're never going to see it.
John!
And if they did, they'd put it on the Osbourne.
Let's be turkey soda. Pass me turkey soda.
Turkey soda.
Turkey and gravy soda.
Why buy the cow when Angelina Jolie will buy it for you?
The hot but kooky actress is now putting her money into a program to donate cows to poverty-stricken farmers in Cambodia.
What is she, Buzz?
She's the hot but kooky actress, Angelina Jolie.
Very good.
That's the nation, Cambodia, from which she adopted her baby and where she now has a second home.
Mm-hmm. The Widow Thornton.
Building one there, yes. She's donated $1.5 million. There's one of the cows.
Well, you know why she left him.
Why?
Billy Bob?
He was a bad Santa.
Angelina's donated $1.5 million so far to the cow giveaway in Cambodia. Each family...
Hey, you know those cows?
Yeah.
Don't get them going.
Mm-hmm.
She does this a lot?
Yeah.
They're going to get mad.
Yeah.
Mad cow.
You just got that
yeah,
one?
No, I got it.
I was waiting for the milk to come out.
The milk only comes out when you get real mad cow. Hey, cow!
And who gave us that? Is that the cow or Angelina Jolie?
Oh.
Each family gets to keep the cow and the cow's first calf. The other offspring go back into the cow giveaway program.
Mm-hmm.
She's got way too much time on her hands and money. What about that little Cambodian baby that she adopted?
She still has.
Shouldn't she be taking care of that baby?
What
and
about
not worry-
the boy?
Yeah, with the boy.
What about the boy?
Instead of a cow, is worry about the boy.
Well, she's over there. She's building a home for the boy in Cambodia and for herself, and decided to buy some cows.
And if the boy ever has a kid, it goes back into the program.
That's right.
Cambodia boy.
Hi, Mr. Peck.
Hello. We must save the boy.
Mr. Peck. I can't do it.
Mr. Peck.
There you go.
Get on my merry-go-round. I'm not staying here anymore. It's tainted.
Are you just glad to see us, or are you from Ohio? Buckeye lawmakers passed a bill yesterday that allows citizens to carry concealed guns. And the governor says he'll sign that bill now that the list of who'll be packing heat will be made public.
Bye, Wendell.
The same building.
I'm just saying goodbye to our engineer.
He's moving
to Ohio right now.
This is the greatest day in the history of Ohio.
The same bill
Winner!
Got derailed last year because lawmakers didn't want reporters to be able to find out who was carrying concealed weapons.
I'm very sorry, but you've lost.
Yes.
All right, real fast. Who wants to play? Who wants to play? Somebody call in right now at 877-365-3636. Who wants to play? Wendell Roulette.
Wendell Roulette. See who's got one in the chamber.
It's been a long time since we've played this game, and I think Wendell can handle it.
Yeah, Wendell can handle this. Yeah.
I think Wendell's okay with this.
Yeah.
You got everything.
I have the theme.
You got the theme?
Yeah.
And if you load the stuff up in the machine.
All the elements are ready.
Then we'll take the first call.
Wendell Hall Roulette.
Chambers are full.
Hold on, let me get the music here. Hold on, give me a second. Just come on, cue up, please. Cut number 14.
Lock and load.
Music. We got a caller. Hello. Don and Mike show. Hi.
Hi, this is Gladys. Can I play? I know you
want... No. Hi, Don and Mike show. Hello.
Hi, Beth.
Hey, guys. How you doing?
We're doing great. Who's this?
This is Steve.
All right, Steve. You know, Robbie, this thing is not queuing up with the music.
Mm-hmm.
We're trying to do an impromptu edition of Wendell Hall's Empty Chamber. And now, who knows? You might be the winner. Oh, there's our theme.
There it is.
You might be the winner. You might not be the winner.
I think this is still right.
You think this is still right? All right, well, first, here's our engineer, Wendell Hall, describing the gun that he'll be pointing at his temple.
Hi, this is Wendell Hall. In all this excitement, I sort of forgot myself. This is a Smith & Wesson 44 Magnum, the most powerful handgun in the world. So what you've got to be asking yourself is, do you feel lucky? Well, do you, punk?
That's right.
Wendell
pointed at his... Wendell doesn't point it at his head. The contestant points it at their head.
I'm sorry.
Good luck.
That's a different game.
Are you ready, sir?
Yes, I am.
All right, Wendell, if you would please close the cylinder. Okay.
Spin it.
And now...
Now we're going to ask the caller to put the gun to his head.
Will you put the gun to your head, sir?
Yes, I will.
And...
Let's pull the trigger, see what happens.
Hey, you're lucky.
Empty chamber.
Sorry, you're a loser.
No, that means he wins.
No, he wins,
Doc. I always get this messed up.
He's a winner, and he's a loser, of course, if the gun goes off. Like that.
Good luck.
Okay. Whatever, I just screwed up that whole game.
That's okay, this guy won.
But
he won a prize.
That's how you play Wendell Hall's Empty Chamber.
Empty Chamber really worked better when we were in that restaurant at LAX.
You have won the Curb Your Enthusiasm prize pack.
Catch all the new episodes of the Larry David Show, Curb Your Enthusiasm, and Sex in the City on HBO every Sunday night. Starts with the final season of Sex at 9, 8 Central, followed by Curb, 9:30, 8:30 Central, only on HBO. And remember,
winner!
You're a winner.
Yes, he gets angry when they don't shoot themselves.
Get shot, is he there?
I'm very sorry, but you've lost.
See, now he's happy because they actually shot themselves.
Wendell Hall's empty chamber.
Good luck.
There you go. Thanks for listening.
And he doesn't mean that. He's smiling evilly when he says good luck.
Good luck.
Thanks for playing. Good luck. Oh, yeah, let me try.
And
let me try it.
Winner!
Oh, no.
I'm very sorry, but you've lost.
Mike's alive.
Good luck.
Right.
I'm here.
Well, the vote to approve concealed guns in Ohio was overwhelming. Quoting one Democratic lawmaker who voted against, it's a complete cave-in to the gun lobby. And the National Rifle Association wants to have its own radio or TV channel so
good
it can
luck.
Get around the law that limits what it can spend on getting pro-gun candidates elected.
Good luck.
The NRA figures if it's declared a news organization, it'll be exempt.
Oh, come on.
Quoting NRA big shot Wayne LaPierre, we're as...
Then again, change that name.
Wayne LaPierre?
Yeah, I mean, if you're going to be... I know I've said it before. You're going to be head of the NRA.
Uh-huh. Yeah, you ought to have a name like Clint Black.
Right. Or like, you know, my name is Bill Muskie.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. How you doing?
Bill Muskie and I work for the NRA, but no. My name is Wayne LaPierre.
He says, we're...
That's as bad as Lyndon... Hi, this is Lyndon LaRouche.
Have you heard that radio commercial?
Oh, have I?
My God, man. Where he's like, hi. This is Lyndon LaRouche.
Yeah, it's like Larry Bud Melman talking into the wrong end of the microphone.
Doing a press conference from a Texaco restroom.
Well, Wayne LaPierre says, we're as legitimate a media outlet as Disney or Viacom. Why should not NRA be considered as legitimate as a news source as they are?
Why should not?
That's what he said.
I know, bro.
The NRA hopes to get gun makers to help foot the bill, even though it's already one of Washington's most powerful lobbies. And the gun group says it'll consider anchoring a ship in international waters, if it has to beam its message into the United States.
God, that'd be a fun ship to be on.
Okay. Yo-ho, yo-ho.
Pirate's life for me.
I'm Wayne LaPierre.
That's a good pirate name.
Yeah.
Finally, drive-through customers at a Burger King in Troy, Michigan are not having it their way. Police say someone has tapped into the drive-up intercom and is using it to hurl obscene insults at the customer.
Now, that's great.
That is great.
When the manager came out to apologize to customers, the voice on the speaker said, get back inside and take your goons with you. So whoever it is watching.
Listen, I'd like a Whopper with cheese and a large Coke, please.
F-face. And, you know, most times, it might as well be because you can never understand them anyway.
Right, I'd like it if they'd use a little profanity. You're up in fries already.
The manager says he's trying to get the frequency changed to, in his words, minimize customer irritation. I'm Buzz Burbank on the Don and Mike Show.
Thank you, Buzz.
No! No!
That's it.
Let's see. Good show today. Happy birthday, Elvis. Joe Gibbs. Right. Daniel. You are my brother.
Daniel,
you were something to me. Almost sound like that guy. Take me out to go. And Alto V's Davis.
Yeah.
Tomorrow we'll have the new episode, Joe's X-rated tape with the retards. And also Jim Nance.
Yes.
And the brand new low-budget Jeff Hardy.
Wonderful.
All of that on tomorrow's episode. That's it. Got to go. See you then. Good day to you, sir.
Good day to you, sir.
And good day to you, sir.
Good day to you, sir.
And you.
I am trainable.
BM.
Eaters.
Till we meet again. This is Sammy Davis Jr. saying, be kind, be nice. And I hope the next performer has the pleasure of having as nice an audience as you've been tonight.
This.
And let me leave you swinging.
The Don and Mike Show.